family of networks. The highest standard in sports television, including the CBS Sports Network, Showtime Sports, CBSSports.com, and the CBS Sports Radio Network. The best in sports online, on radio, and on the air. CBS Sports. Expect it here.
This is the state of Alabama. Gentle with its southern beauty and elegance, but fierce in its personality and pride. For more than a century, life was centered around the burgeoning iron industry in the city of Birmingham and the two college football teams, Alabama and Auburn, whose rivalry burns as hot as the molten steel the state created. Their shared passion for the game remains timeless, and the pursuit of gridiron glory unquestioned. But their personalities are as different as night and day. Alabama imposes its will with brute force and an unflinching discipline. Auburn's success is rooted in the sleight of hand and a soaring spirit, thanks to the occasional wing and a prayer.
A miracle in Jordan-Hare! A miracle in Jordan-Hare!
Even in the most benign of times, this is a rivalry that is forged, much like the iron itself, in smoldering cauldrons, filled with emotion and intensity. But these are no ordinary days. For the first time ever, Alabama plays Auburn in a winner-take-all showdown. And to the victor go the spoils. A trip to the SEC championship game and the possibility of so much more. This is the 78th Iron Bowl.
There is a huge gathering of fans outside Jordan-Hare Stadium this afternoon. While the Tigers make their traditional Tiger walk to come inside Jordan-Hare, a small group of vocal Alabama fans here to cheer on the undefeated Crimson Tide and their head coach, Nick Saban. Inside Jordan-Hare, all the pageantry that makes life in the SEC so special, but this one this afternoon especially so. We welcome you to the Home Depot SEC on CBS. It's the 78th Iron Bowl featuring Alabama, number one, and Auburn, number four. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist along with Gary Danielson here at Jordan-Hare. There's a couple in the stands today, J.R. and Carol Parrish, who attended their first Iron Bowl in 1951 when he was a freshman at Auburn. In the subsequent 62 years, they've been to most of them. They sent me a text earlier this week in which they insisted that because of all that is at stake today, this is the most important Iron Bowl ever played. That's good enough for me. Let's take a quick look at what is at stake today. First of all, for the first time ever, it's a winner-take-all game between these two. The winner will play in the SEC Championship next week against either Missouri or South Carolina. But in a broader fashion, take a look at the BCS standings released last Sunday. Alabama on top, Florida State, Ohio State next, and then Auburn almost unbelievably in the number four position. Gary Danielson, we've been listening to people all week long and talking about pressure. Who's got the biggest amount of pressure in this game?
Well, it's different for both teams, and it may shift back and forth. And we love these pressurized games with high consequences, and obviously we got one. But I think it's going to start out with Alabama in this football game. When you're trying to go a three-peat for the national championship, you're going to have to go through Auburn, your rival. Yes, at the beginning of this football game, all the pressure starts with Alabama. But it shifts throughout the game because the Auburn team comes here loose. The start of the game, they're all smiles. Their fans are saying, we survived. We've got another life. But, you know, late in this football game, if they look up at that clock and they have a chance to win, it may shift over to them.
You know, we've had at least a two-week buildup to this. I think we've heard and listened and seen so many different opinions about what the keys are to this game. You're the expert. You got the last word.
I got the last chance to be wrong.
Yeah.
Okay, here we we go. It is kind of fun, though, because in 2 weeks, you do all these interviews, you listen to everybody, talk to 10 experts, you get 20 opinions. They're all kind of right as you watch these things gun through. It could be anything in these type of games. It's why the coaches work so hard. But for me, I don't think you have to go searching too wide on this one. I think Auburn runs the ball great. Alabama stops the run. I'll go with that one as being the key to the game. But we do know, Vern, it usually finds the quarterbacks. And we've got two great ones in this game. A.J. McCarron is going to make a run at the Heisman. He's going to get two huge stages. If he wins today in the SEC Championship 2 weeks from now, three championships, State's a big case, and he has to come through. The Auburn quarterback's a little different. A big challenge for this Alabama team. Nick Marshall is a tremendous athlete. He can beat him with his feet, and if the run game's going, he can beat him with his arm. We've got two great ones at quarterback.
A crowd of about 90,000 now settling in. Well, settling in is perhaps not the right phrase. The passion in this place is enormous. This is the 78th meeting between these two. The series started in 1892, but was suspended from 1907 till 1948. Now, Alabama has had its way in the last 5 years. They've won four. The teams did not play, as you see, from 08 to 47, and the last four winners here have won the BCS National Championship. First on the field, Alabama. Almost simultaneously, here come the Tigers of Auburn. Let's go down to Tracy Wolfson with Nick Saban.
Thanks a lot, Vern. Coach, we know the hype that went into this one. We know how loud this stadium can be, but we also know how many big games your team has played, and how can that help you here today?
Well, you know, I think the big thing for our players, a lot of motion in this game. We got to stay focused on what we need to do to execute. Everybody do their job, play with discipline, be physical, play the way we play. I mean, that's, and we got to do it for 60 minutes in the game. So that's what we got to do, and it's tough in this environment, but that's what we got
to
do.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it. Turn back to you.
All right, Tracy, thank you. Gus Malzahn, the first-year head coach at Auburn, declined an interview with Tracy Wolfson. Back with the kick after this. The Home Depot SEC. We welcome you back to Auburn, Alabama. The Alabama Crimson Tide won the toss, and they have elected to go on offense. It just could not be a more perfect day. A slight breeze out of the east, 55 degrees, and partly cloudy skies. Christian Jones, who opened the season with a 94-yard kickoff return against Virginia Tech. But the man who is kicking off for the Auburn Tigers is Cody Parkey. He leads the country in touchbacks, but this will not be one of them. It's Jones. And a positive way for Alabama to begin the game. Let's take a look at the Chick-fil-A starting lineups. A.J. McCarron, 36-2 as a starter.
And he's got a great feeling for Auburn the last 2 years. 33 for 44, 7 touchdowns, no interceptions the last 2 times against Auburn.
Three wides, top of the screen. That's Vogler, the tight end, who sets tight right. McCarron out of the spread. The handoff to Yeldon. Huge hole up the middle. What a start for the Crimson Tide. 31 yards.
Alabama shifted right, unbalanced, and Austin Shepherd just blew his man right past the hole.
And a first down at the 45-yard line. Yeldon over 1,000 yards. Again this season, he did so as a freshman, and this year as a sophomore, Amari Cooper in motion to the right side. Four-man Auburn rush, quick screen, it's Cooper. Well, you bet, A.J. McCarron. Let's introduce you to the remainder of the Alabama offense. The Quanjo brothers on the left side. Ryan Kelly hobbled a little bit, but he will get the start today. That was a game-time decision. Steen and Shepherd in the backfield. It's Yeldon. And the wideouts are DeAndre White, Cooper, and Kevin Norwood. First down, 10. This time, Norwood and Cooper are near side, with Cooper in the slot. And that's Norwood, I beg your pardon. Cooper's the outside man. Try Yeldon again. Ladarius Owens, one of the frontline defenders for Auburn. Ford, who's had a terrific season as a pass rusher. Igwe, Wright, Owens. McKenzie Holland, Therese is the star. D. Ford has helped save two significant wins, most recently with a last-second tackle on Aaron Murray to end.
And, Vern, it is Chad Lindsey that started the game, number 78 at center, instead of Ryan Kelly.
Second down, 5. Yeldon slips the tackle inside the 30. Now let's go back to the studio for this Ford update. Here is Tim Brando.
Vern, Gary, number 3 in peril. It's 42-41 after a touchdown. Brady Hoke decides to go for 2. Devin Gardner is picked off by Tyvus Powell. Ohio State hangs on by the scantest of margins. There will be some debate, however, if they are that other team that's undefeated playing for the national championship. Back to you.
They're down 2. Jalston Fowler is tight to Vogler on the left side. Yeldon, the only running back. He gets it, comes left.
Good penetration.
Driven down.
Yes.
It's Jake Holland and Robinson Teruzzi. Fourth down.
One of the questions was, could the undersized Auburn defensive line stand up to the strength of Alabama? On that third and short, they did. Remember, Vern, in the LSU game, LSU stopped them twice on third and short, forced Nick Saban to do a fake punt. They've had trouble third and short.
Cade Foster for the season, 11 of 12. This is from 44, McCarron the holder. That's
going
to go left.
This looked out of sync. I was looking into the interior of the line, but I don't know if Cade Foster... He seemed like he was leaning forward and a little bit off balance and then just hooked it. See how he's leaning? Just looked like he was anticipating the snap before it happened. Got out in front of himself and pulled it.
That's only his second miss of the season. Alabama starts strong, comes up wide left. We are still scoreless in Auburn after Cade Foster of Alabama missed to the left side. Let's introduce you to the Chick-fil-A starting lineups. And the quarterback for the Auburn Tigers, Nick Marshall.
Well, they say he can't throw. I don't want to say he can't do anything. He's an elite athlete. Of course, Auburn needs to run the ball to help him, but he's got a big arm.
Let's take a look at the offensive line. Robinson at left tackle is a terrific athlete. Down at the bottom, Ricardo Lewis, wide receiver, star of the prayer at Jordan-Hare. He made an extremely difficult catch on a tip ball to help win the Georgia game 2 weeks ago. Here's Marshall. Sweep right. Corey Grant, surprise starter. He gets the start in place of Trey Mason. And he picks up 14. The tackle made by Ha-Ha Clinton Dix.
Jay Prosh got another good block on the edge. You want to watch a guy that has to come through and probably will come through. It'll be number 35.
And now Trey Mason is on the field. Hand off to Mason. C.J. Mosley, number 32, was up high. Quick start for Auburn.
Yeah, couldn't quite get it. Alabama was very confused right even prior to the snap. They were still switching players, never got set, and never got their defense set to stop the speed sweep.
Gain of three, second and seven, just over the 45-yard line. Mason is alongside Marshall. This time the give is up the middle. It'll be third down. Defensively, this team very strong against the run, so it's strength on strength. Down at the bottom, Landon Collins replaced an injured Vinny Sunseri, and he and Ha-Ha Clinton Dix, who had to sit out a two-game suspension, are two of the best tackling safeties in college football. Third down, four.
And for Auburn, you don't know if it's a rundown or a pass down.
Right. Take the reverse. Marshall chased. Lets it go deep, wide open, incomplete. Guess who? Ricardo Lewis. Now, the pass was a little to the right.
A little to the right. He was open by 15 yards on the play. A complete bust by the Alabama defense. Watch this. Ha-Ha Clinton Dix was back there. Let him run right by him. Nobody on the field. Ha-Ha Clinton, or is that Cyrus Jones? It was Cyrus Jones, excuse me. Cyrus Jones is turning around and trying to figure out what to do. It's like Alabama has never seen this offense before, and you wonder if their quarterback on defense, Vinny Sunseri, isn't already missed.
Here's the punt from Stephen Clark. And that's a rarity. Touchback.
I've never seen Alabama bust on a play-action pass that bad.
Wow. It was the freshman, Cyrus Jones, Ricardo Lewis. This was at the end of the play, catchable. Tough, but catchable. And Marshall in a state of disbelief. The last drive, the opening drive for the Alabama Crimson Tide, Gary, started off with this huge run by Yeldon.
Well, remember, Alabama won the toss and took the ball. And they were trying to make a statement in this game that we're going to run it and kind of pulled that weakness for the Auburn defense. But they got a stop on third and short and then a pulled field goal. You know, we talked about in the open that the pressure was on Alabama, and Nick Saban said to Tracy, we just have to do our job, read our keys, and concentrate. So far, Alabama is showing they're feeling the pressure.
First down, 10, second possession. Yeldon McCarron under center this time. Quick setup, comes left. Amari Cooper. Cooper bothered by a bad toe most of the season. Had 1,000 yards in receptions as a freshman. Far short of that this year.
Well, he's the fastest receiver. Alabama people say that he's the closest they've had as the game breaker, like the Julio Jones type receiver. He really hasn't lived up to that Julio Jones level in my mind.
McCarron was recalling earlier with us, his first completion was to Julio Jones, and his first touchdown was to the same. Yeldon, not much. Carl Lawson, number 55. Well, A.J. McCarron has had a terrific career at Alabama. 36-2. Most impressive is 13 interceptions in his career and 977 pass completions, pass attempts. Third and three.
Vern, is on the right side of the Alabama offensive line.
He's matched up against Austin Shepard McCarron. Norwood can't hang on.
It was inaccurate, though. He had him wide open, and McCarron did not put the ball on the chest of the receiver. And you saw McCarron go right to Norwood and said, that one's on me. Easy slant, has him wide open, and it's behind him. On those short throws, it's very difficult for the wide receiver to react on those balls, and that's a bad throw by McCarron.
That brings on Cody Mandel. Well, that's two players we've had, one on either side, that look like wrestling referees. One, two, three, you're done. Fourth and three, Mandel averaging 47.3. Chris Davis has a punt return. Oh, it's bobbled. An attempt. How about that? Davis hops up.
My goodness, he dropped the ball. Is Alabama tight or what? Ryan Smith is going, my goodness, what was I doing? I should have blocked it. He goes to hold it. Now watch him just drop it. Ryan Smith delayed and then almost he tipped it, but he should have eaten it up.
Yes. My gosh.
And he's got a glove on it. Vern, it's almost summer-like out here, and he's wearing a glove. A tight Alabama football. I suspected it, but boy, they are tight.
Take a look at the other end. Chris Davis, it bounces.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure why they whistled it dead.
Me either. No fair catch
call. It must have been an inadvertent whistle when they stopped it.
Oof, stop. .31 to go in the first, and let's Gary take another look at that punt.
For the second time in this game, Alabama has dodged a huge play. Ryan Smith actually hits the ball before Cody Mandel's foot hits the ball. Unbelievable that he even got that away. Now watch the receiver here. See if there was a fair catch signal before he waved it off, and that's why it was whistled. Punt goes. I don't see any fair catch at all. I think that was just a missed call in the backfield there.
Yep. It was ruled a fair catch by the officiating
crew. He's blocking the sun. He's looking right into the sun on the play. Had his hand up to shield his eyes. And that's why the official blew the whistle.
First down 10, Auburn. From their own 34.5-yard line. Trey Mason is the running back. And C.J. Uzomah, for the moment, now he goes in motion, number 81. Marshall. Marshall keeps it around the left side. Flag is thrown. They're tricky, aren't they?
They're tricky, but you're also got, you see the 4-4 speed of how Marshall can get outside
holding
the Alabama defense.
Offense 81, 10-yard penalty, repeat first down.
With a little help of a hold.
Yes, Uzomah. The tight end slash wide receiver.
No one in college football will be more aggressive in changing their defense when Auburn goes in motion. They do not want to get outflanked. And talking to Nick Friday night, he knows this. Gus Malzahn on offense. If you just stand there, he'll outflank you. He believes you have to be multiple when they go in motion and shift right with them.
After the holding call, it's first down 18. From the 25. Quick flip, right side. Ricardo Lewis, number 5. And he is double teamed at the lead tackle, Jerick Williams, number 20.
Alabama loves to go with their nickel defense, and their nickel defense means they bring on another safety. That's Kirby Smart right there. They're actually playing 3 safeties. All of them are great tacklers. Landon Collins and Ha-Ha Dix. Clinton Dix being the other 2.
And again, Vinny Sunseri, another sure tackler, is on the injured list for the year. Nick Perry, they lost as a safety very early in the season. Second and 16.
Gus Malzahn calls all the plays from the sideline. Everybody looks over. They got cards, but Gus actually signals to the quarterback.
That's Marcus Davis, top of the screen. Timeout called. Play clock was winding down.
Of course, these two teams have faced each other a lot when Gus was the offensive coordinator against Kirby Smart, the defensive coordinator, but they're both not used to seeing those kind of plays earlier.
Back at Jordan-Hare, and let's go back to that fair catch or whatever it was. Steve Shaw, director of officials for the SEC, called our truck and said when Chris Davis yelled get away and made the lateral movement, that equals a fair catch. And the whistle blows, and there you have it. Now it's time to take a look at our Home Depot tools for success.
Well, here, look at what Auburn does with their offense that gives everyone problems. I call it a form of the triple option because it all looks the same. Watch these three plays. They start out exactly the same. The first phase is the dive play. This time to Trey Mason. Again, same start. The second phase, obviously, fake it to Trey Mason, keep Nick Marshall. The third phase, a little different wrinkle. Start again, same fake mesh, pull it out and throw it the long pitch. Same look, same start, and the master's been running this offense since high school. He knows how to dial it up.
14 years as a high school coach in Arkansas. 14 years. There you go. And it's Corey Grant in trouble. There's Landon Collins, the sophomore, made the tackle.
It's one of the challenges when you play Alabama. They are the best back seven tackling defense in college football. Their corners and their safeties tackle better than anybody on tape. Now, coming up like that, you know there'll be another play action pass soon.
Well, we've got a third and 18. Last time we were here late in the game, there was a fourth and 18, just about this same spot. That one led to a deflected touchdown in the hands of Ricardo Lewis. This early in the game, the consequences not quite as severe. Oh, they just did they get it away, or did they have to
Gus call timeout
yep.
again?
That's two.
Interesting timeout to use both of them. It's not a likely, you know, this part of the field is putting a lot of pressure on Nick Marshall, who doesn't have a lot of experience on third and very long. I think maybe discretion would be a better call here and punt the ball.
Time has been taken, 6:23 to go, opening quarter. We'll step aside. Now at cbssports.com/SEC. So two timeouts taken by Auburn, and we're only halfway through the first quarter.
And this is the dangerous down, third and long. Auburn throws the ball well on fourth and long.
Yeah.
No, but on third and long, they better be careful. They are not built for third and long, especially backed up like they are now.
And Kirby Smart, the defensive coordinator for Alabama, has gone with six defensive backs. Third and 18. Bit of a low snap. Marshall rolls out to his right. Drills it, got him! Sammy Coates, how do you do?
In the orchestrated play, the called play, nothing there. But Nick Marshall gets outside the pocket. That's the breakdown.
That's a gain of 21. They go quickly after the made first down. Mason darts left. Coates, who's averaging 22.7 per catch with a 21-yarder.
Got outside, broke down the defense.
And back live, here's Mason, little stutter step behind the line. He doesn't get much. Ed Stinson, number 49 for the Crimson Tide with the tackle.
Auburn has never, in the two games we did, the 2010 game at Alabama when they beat them and won the national championship. They only ran 61 plays, did Auburn, in that football game. They never really got the up-tempo game going.
Third down, two.
You have to make first downs to get the up-tempo going.
Reese Dismukes the center, over the ball. Marshall, big hole. Collins chases him and can't catch him. And Nick Marshall has scored the first touchdown of the ball game. 45 yards.
Looks like they're going to try for two.
They always line up that way. Check out the numbers.
Okay, gotcha.
And if it's not there, they kick the extra point or fake it from here.
Ryan White, who was the deep man, is also the holder. And here is Cody Parkey. 7-0 Auburn.
So what happened on this play? Trey Mason is being read by C.J. Mosley on the play. You run the play just as we showed it before. The keeper, Mosley, runs himself out of the play. Doesn't even have to be blocked. A wide open hole. And nobody's going to catch this guy. He's an elite athlete.
And Greg Robinson with the block on Jeffrey Pagan helped clear the way. Marshall with a 45-yard run over left tackle. Let's take a look from the Chick-fil-A action cam.
Well, besides Fool and Mosley, understand that Corzon right here and Robinson have the two defenders in a combo block. Because Mosley gets fooled, they can push Pagan out a little farther, and then Robinson finishes it off. A little bit of deception, a little bit of hesitation, and a lot of speed.
Now Nick Marshall, in his first year as a starter, think about this. A year ago when A.J. McCarron was leading Alabama to a 49-0 win, Nick Marshall had concluded his one season as the quarterback at Garden City Community College. Here's the end zone. Marshall's last game at Garden City was a 56-7 loss to Butler Community College. He has traveled a circuitous route to this spot.
You know, Vern, it's a tough start for Alabama. Just think about this. Poor substitutions on that first series by Alabama. A missed field goal. A blown coverage that should have been a touchdown. They almost dropped the punt. It could have been a disaster. And then a right up the gut touchdown. Holy cow.
Yes. First down 10, McCarron at the 25. Amari Cooper in motion. Yeldon gets 5. Jermaine Whitehead, number 9, makes the tackle.
Well, this Auburn defense is giving up 255 yards a game passing, 98th in the country. But four different teams has run for more than 200 yards against the defense. What does Alabama choose to do? Because right now they have to believe they're going to have to score.
Second and 5 here. On their opening drive, they missed a 44-yard field goal and then had a bad punt. Here's McCarron. Right through the hands of DeAndre White. Third and 5.
Third down.
Again, just a bit high. A
little bit.
Not comfortable. A tight football team. I'm going to say it over and over again. Alabama has to weather this storm. Get comfortable in the game. They're not there yet.
Third and 5. Blitz. McCarron across the middle, crossing pattern. White short.
Well, let's see. They're spotting it right at the line.
Yeah, Jonathan Mincy made a nice tackle on the play. It's a trademark play, crossing routes. Hit him. Mincy makes the tackle, but it is fourth and very short, and they're going to line up in punt formation.
Yeah, no measurement. Here's Mandel. Chris Davis is deep. And he goes even deeper. As we said, Mandel averaging 47.3. This is only his 35th punt of the season. This is a fair catch call. And it's taken in the sun at the 15. Doubleheader tomorrow, the NFL today on CBS. League game early, New England at Houston. There are three others in the early spot. And then Jim and Phil have made the short trip from Dallas to Kansas City. Denver and the Chiefs tomorrow. It all begins with the NFL today, presented by Southwest Airlines at 12 noon tomorrow. 7-0 Auburn here on the 45-yard touchdown run of Nick Marshall. As I think many of you know, began his career as a defensive back at Georgia, dismissed from the team, took the JC route at Garden City. Mason.
One of the things that you can watch in this game, if you're here in the stands, is the two coordinators, basically Kirby Smart against Gus Malzahn. You get the head coach calling plays for one side and the offensive defensive coordinator for the other.
Fumble. Marshall recovered his own drop ball.
Got a first down. They're going to go fast. Another one of those keepers. Picked out that time with a trade to Priest, I think, is the guy who got his hand on it.
Twice. First down, 10 at the 29. 2:45 to go.
Kirby against Gus. They will both change and switch plays throughout the drive. Pointing down means run it.
And it's Mason again. Mason, somewhat controversially in this game a year ago, with the thing decided 49-0, carried the ball on a final play to go over 1,000 for the year. No such problem today. He's well over 1,000 already. Well, already this Alabama defense, so good against the run, has given up a 45-yarder for a touchdown.
I've talked to so many coaches that say they read the alignment of number 35, Prosh, to take him to the play.
Marshall chased and dropped. Jonathan Allen, number 93, gets credit for the sack. True freshman.
Jonathan Allen is one of three true freshmen that played for this defense, but he was chased out that time by Xavier Dixon, wasn't
right.
he?
Yeah.
Dixon made the play, and Allen cleaned it up.
And so third down, 12. Kirby Smart has made his personnel adjustments defensively. Now third and 18 on the last drive. They found Sammy Coates for a 21-yard gain. Sweep right, Mason. Ouch. Wow. Denzel Duvall, number 30, led that one. Jerick Williams was there.
It's as successful as Auburn has been running right at this defense. One of the reasons is they're willing to run the speed sweep. They're spreading out that Alabama defense and then attacking them inside. They can't stop doing either. You have to attack Alabama all over the field. I think Gus is doing a good job of keeping Alabama defense off balance.
Stephen Clark is on to punt. Auburn's punt return has allowed only four returns all year for 4 yards. And here's another fair catch taken by Christian Jones. That's a remarkable statistic.
The punt travels 43 yards.
Monday on CBS, People's Choice Award, easy for me to say, People's Choice Award nominee Melissa McCarthy and Billy Gardell star in a new episode of the hit comedy Mike and Molly, Monday at 9, 8 Central, only CBS.
We had a nice conversation with the veteran defensive coordinator from Auburn about saying, listen, they're going to hit some passes on us, but their big plays come from play-action passes and running the ball. We can't lose patience and try to make big plays. Just stop the run.
Gary's talking about Ellis Johnson. Here's a deep ball right side. He's got him open. Incomplete. Amari Cooper and Jermaine Whitehead. It looked like Cooper had a half a stride.
He did. I thought A.J. waited too long on this pass. Watch how Amari Cooper never has to accelerate. He has to slow down. If that's out there, he would have scored. He actually pushed off on the play, and it was probably underthrown by about 5 to 6 yards.
Second down and 10. Kenyon Drake is the running back now. He's the speedster. He spells T.J. Yeldon with regularity. Second and 10. Auburn showing a blitz. They're coming from the corner. Kenyon Drake breaks around the right side and is out across the 40.
Yeah, that's what that same formation they used when T.J. Yeldon hit the long run. On balance line and then run the inside play very effectively.
The injured Auburn player is Ryan White, number 19. Ouch. Looks like he made contact with that right shoulder. Another look at it. Oh, perhaps a knee hit his head.
Yeah, I think his left knee.
Yep.
Got him right in the back of the head, didn't it?
Yep. Yes, that's exactly what it was. Your spotter Butch Baird is on his game today.
He always is. That's why he makes the big bucks up
yeah,
here.
Yeah, well, don't say that because that's going to upset David Moulton and Chuck Gardner, who are also helping us out. That's an early pop, by the way. Ryan White. That's a good sight to see. Trotting off unaided. First and 10. Now, Tracy will update us on White, but he appears to be okay. We'll do concussion test, of course.
What an interesting, read an interesting quote from AJ this week. He said, I think we play best when we play fast. They're starting to do a little bit of what Aaron Murray did against Auburn. No huddle spread.
Draw play, and it's Kenyon Drake. And we have reached the end of one, a 45-yard touchdown scamper by Nick Marshall for the Auburn Tigers. And they've trailed just once in the previous 15 games after the first quarter. They've won 18 in a row on the road or in neutral sites. We're back after this message and a word from your local. Jordan-Hare Stadium, Auburn, Alabama. Just a moment ago, Bo Jackson, one of the greatest athletes ever in collegiate athletics, and of course a star here at Auburn. Happy birthday to Bo, his 51st birthday today. That does not help me feel young.
Looks like he can still suit up, doesn't he?
No kidding. Oh, he was something. We begin the second down and one. McCarron. And he's got Kenyon Drake in the backfield. Two wides to the right side. They'll feed Kenyon Drake. Big hole up the middle. And that is another Alabama first down. I just think we should go back to the beginning of the program. And, Gary, you said the pressure was on Alabama. It's been manifested here.
They're the tighter team. A.J. McCarron's feeling it. They're all feeling it right now. But you have to give Auburn credit. They're averaging 320 yards rushing a game. They're 80 in the first quarter. That's right on target. And Nick Marshall made the play in the pocket on third and long. And then he made the play with the option. Right now, Auburn is doing it exactly the way they want to do it on offense. Let's see if Alabama can answer.
Blitz coming. Play action, McCarron's down.
Gabe came right up the gut on him that time. It was a blitz. I think that's Gabe right there. Yes, he gets handed off, a missed assignment by the offensive line. It was just a middle linebacker blitz, and the Alabama offensive line did not handle it, turned somebody completely free.
They had given up only 5 sacks in the last 9 games at the Alabama offensive line. That's the first today. They gave up 4 in the season opener against Virginia Tech. It's second down and 16. Straight four-man rush. McCarron left side. Christian Jones. Incomplete.
Boy, there's nobody helping him out either, is there? I mean, this is a ball that I think Christian Jones, we've seen Alabama players make this catch. They got to come down with a couple. You got a team on the road starting to feel a little bit like 2010 when Auburn couldn't get started in that game when they were feeling the pressure. They finally found their way, obviously. But right now, nobody's making a big play for Alabama.
Alabama 0-for-3. On third down conversions, a big one here, third and 16. 3 down for the Tigers. They bring 5. McCarron, crossing pattern. DeAndre White, number 2. Tackle made by Jermaine Whitehead.
Yeah, a little bit by the umpire, too.
Yeah.
The ball went exactly where Auburn wanted it to go. A quick slant, but then White goes, oh, he had to dodge the umpire, and then couldn't dodge the 2 guys. Whitehead makes the tackle.
4th and 7. Well, let's see what they're going to do here.
Boy, I'm surprised at this.
Me too. McCarron is still on the field. 4th down and 7.
I bet they just let the clock run out, don't you think? Well, they took a timeout. They're still thinking about going for this.
McCarron and Saban. It's 4th and 7. We welcome you back. The conversation continues. And early miscues.
Yeah, just, you know, obviously the missed field goal when they had the good drive on the first drive. Dropping the ball, something hard to believe he was fortunate enough even to get it off because Ryan Smith touched it before the punter did. And McCarron just a bit off, not playing like AJ usually does. Behind, a little high, a little late. And then when he needs a little help to the outside, the only guy that comes through for him is Lee Corso in the background right there, picking up the ball in the background.
Well, I saw this morning that he did pick Alabama to win it. Well, how about this decision?
It is odd now. You know, remember, they could take a 5-yard penalty and punt. Do they try to draw him off or are they running the play? Well, exactly what happened.
How about that?
Because they could take a 5-yard penalty and just punt afterwards. 4th and 2 isn't as bad to go for it. D. Ford's pointing to Alabama.
Offside, defense number 30, unabated the quarterback. 5-yard penalty results in the first down.
Matt Austin is our referee today.
That's a big mental mistake by senior D. Ford right there. Because now, 4th and 2, you like it a lot better than 4th and 7. And here come the big guys in.
Yep. This is the ultimate jumbo package. Brian Vogler, number 84. Jalston Fowler, number 45. Vogler, 260. Fowler, 250. Kenyon Drake is the runner.
0-for-4 so far. I don't think they're in the right formation.
They had to call time.
They're going to have to.
That's the second time out in this drive.
Right from the start, A.J. McCarron was trying to move guys around. They break the huddle. Now watch McCarron right away. Wait, you're on the wrong side. He starts pointing. O.J., you're on the... Wait a second. Now I'm not... I got to take a timeout.
Please direct your attention to AUHD.
You think this please Nick Saban? Not quite. welcome you back to Auburn. 7-0 here. Let's take a look at that penalty a moment ago. Well, it seemed to be induced.
Yeah, well, look what's happening earlier. Auburn is starting to get a read on new center Chad Lindsay. He dips his head, lifts it up, and snaps it. Auburn is getting the tempo of that and trying to anticipate. But in this one, he lifts it and doesn't snap it. That's why I'm not so sure Alabama was even going to go for it. I think they were trying to pull him off and then go for it if it ended up being 4th and 2.
He is in the starting lineup because of the injury to Ryan Kelly. And on 4th and 2, they will go Kenyon Drake. That's Norwood in motion number 83. O.J. Howard tight to the right side. McCarron lobs it to O.J. Howard. He's going to become a huge force in Alabama football. That's a gain of 11.
Well, good job by Kenyon Drake to get the block, get one-on-one to the backside with Ryan Smith. And now you have to say, Auburn burned 2 timeouts in their scoring drive. Alabama burns 2 timeouts. 7 points. It'll be a good trade.
Vogler way out to the top of the screen, wide left. 1st and 10, Alabama trailing by 7. McCarron settles for the safety valve. That's Howard again, and he plunges toward the first down marker. Chris Frost, number 17, made the tackle. That's a gain of 11 again.
Well, there was pressure earlier in this game, but when A.J. McCarron eventually finds his balance point, he's pretty good. He's been through everything. I can only think of him having a couple of rough outings. You know, obviously that 9-6 game in 2011, the first half of the A&M game when they lost to Manziel in 2012.
And despite the victory at Mississippi State, he threw 2 interceptions a couple of weeks ago. Very unusual. Here's Drake. Gets a block to Fowler and is stopped near the 3. And let's get an update from Tracy Wolfson.
Well, guys, actually, T.J. Yeldon running on the field now, but he has been in and out of this game the whole time. He was really standing off to the side for a while there. This is the first time we've seen him go in a while. It was that big run early on that might have re-aggravated that right ankle that kept him out of last week's game, but not getting that much work, and that might be keeping him out of this one, guys.
Okay, Trace.
Got it well taped, I'll tell you that.
Yeah. Fowler is the lead blocker here in the fullback role. Yeldon, number 4, is the deep back. That's Vogler in motion. 2nd and goal. Play action. McCarron lobs it. Caught. Fowler. Touchdown. That's Jalston Fowler's 7th catch of the season. 5 touchdowns. That's a pretty good efficiency rating.
Well, everybody's got this play, and even if you know it's coming, it's still difficult to stop. You run right at him, and then you slip the fullback out to the outside, and that's a tough chase down for Casanova McKenzie.
Cade Foster is on for the extra point try. McCarron will hold, and a freshman, Cole Matza, is the snapper. We're tied. That's an 11-play drive, 67 yards. Took just under 5 minutes.
Well, this was aggressive calling by Nick Saban, and it came through.
Cade Foster will kick off.
Would be nice to, I know it's all sore, would be nice to set a rule that you can't talk about the Heisman until November at least. Wouldn't that be nice?
Yes, it would. Yes, it
kind of shakes out a little bit by November.
Foster kicks it. Trey Mason bobbles it. Picks it up at the 7. And he gets out near the 20-yard line. Mason, who has a kickoff return for a touchdown this year, but it's not going to happen that way. And Reggie Ragland ultimately made the tackle, number 18.
The Auburn folks told us, one of the things they felt in watching every game tape of Alabama, by the way, they watch every game, is that people gave up on the run too early versus Alabama. Didn't they? I mean, it's, mm-hmm. And they are committed, of course, that's the strength of their team, to hanging with the run. We will throw if we can run.
And so far, 81 yards rushing. This is Mason coming to the left. That's popped out after he was down. Landon Collins, number 26, made the tackle. Jerick Williams is going to trot over to the near side. 85 yards now for Auburn. They average 320, as Gary's pointed out, and Alabama yields only 91 per game. Uzuma comes in to provide blocking help. Marshall keeps it this time. Wow.
Well,
Xavier Dixon, yep, was there to plug the gap.
Well defended. Looked like a bit of a busted play, perhaps, to the outside. Jeffrey Pagan does a nice job of running it out to the sideline and then cleaned up. Defending the perimeter. That is one of the big storylines that both coaching staffs told us. Both of them said the same thing. We got to stop the wide game.
Third and eight, Quan Bray, number four, top of the screen. This is Uzuma up on the line in the slot, and the pass goes to him. Boy, he is popped. Jerick Williams was there, and so was C.J. Mosley. But Uzuma held on. It's a gain of 10.
Boy, this is very close, by the way. Hits him, I think, in the arm, in the chest, though. Big slant. Yes, good placement.
Yep.
Good placement by Mosley.
Well, a bleak reference there to the new targeting rule.
Yep.
It was, we had a chance to chat. Here's the play. Left side, Mason. Commissioner Mike's, is it down or out?
It's going to be close.
Sure is.
Yes.
Yeah, Landon Collins recovers the fumble.
It's going to be very close. Landon Collins caused it, I believe, by ripping it. Yes, that ball's out. That's going to be held up. Alabama football.
Agree.
What a job by Collins. C.J. Mosley on the tackle. Collins goes for the football.
Call on the field is fumble. So it is being reviewed upstairs.
Auburn better be ready for the play action pass now.
Robert Bouget, the play stands. No announcement.
What? Officials were signaling a timeout. Did
I wonder if Malzahn called one.
I think
one.
He did call timeout. He wanted to challenge
for the review,
it.
Yeah.
The Auburn head coach has called a timeout to challenge the ruling of a fumble.
You know, I think he reacted, number one, to the crowd and the Jumbotron right up here. He saw it, and I think we got a better look at it.
Yep.
And I think this is going to stand. Before his knee comes out, I think the crowd was looking at this one with orange and blue eyes. Now that ball is starting to come out before the knee hits the ground, in my mind.
Robert Rougeau is the replay official. It's out.
He put his right hand down, but I don't think he got his forearm or elbow down.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Auburn will be charged their third and final timeout of the half. They will have no more challenges throughout the game.
Landon Collins, elite recruit 2 years ago, a five-star number one recruit in the country, runs a 4.44, and listen to this, a 43-inch vertical jump. That's how strong of an athlete he is.
Saw the note, when Alabama wins the turnover battle since 2008, They are undefeated, 47-0. Tie game 7-7, 9:09 to go in the first half. Now Yeldon is back on the field, the running back. McCarron, good downfield coverage. He finds the safety valve, that is Yeldon. Yeldon, who has just made his 17th catch of the year.
This is how you have veteran quarterback and you've earned the trust of your Alabama coaching staff when they call a pass on first down and you're looking for the big play. But if it's not there, just give me the check down. Then you know what will happen? He'll get another one of those first down calls. He's earned that trust.
Norwood and Cooper, top of the screen. O.J. Howard, the tight end, starts this way, then goes back left. They feed it to Yeldon. He is caught behind the line. Casanova McKenzie.
Hit by number 8, Casanova McKenzie.
Oh, Casanova McKenzie, number 8 from the backside, ends up making the play. Cyrus Kwanjo, number 71, kind of trips him from behind while he's blocking. Yeldon doesn't look loose. I think Tracy's right. That right ankle isn't 100%.
Third and 2.
As the game goes on, it could loosen up, but right now he doesn't look normal.
Fowler sets up as the fullback. Yeldon to the 20. First down.
See, this is where that offensive line starts to make an impact. Fowler gets his fit on Jay Collin, number 45 on 5. Cooper blocking downfield. Methodically, those zone blocks. They're not as maybe power-oriented as we've seen the last couple of years, but very efficient that offensive line is.
Again, it's Chad Lindsey at center replacing the injured Ryan Kelly. And you've got the Kwanjo brothers on the left. And then Anthony Steen and Austin Shepard on the right side. First down 10 at the 20 in a tie game blitz. Up the middle, good pickup by Yeldon. That's caught, touchdown, Kevin Norwood, Mr. Reliable for the Alabama Crimson Tide.
Well, we were talking about somebody had to help him out and make a catch. Why don't you go to the guy you've been doing it with for 4 years?
Set it up with the fumble recovery. He ripped it out as well.
And by the way, Vern, T.J. Yeldon had a great block to give A.J. McCarron the time to throw the ball.
Cade Foster on for the extra point. Ooh. Cuts it inside the left upright.
7 minutes, 12 seconds remaining in the second quarter.
Well, Norwood's right here. He's going to get it right down the hash. It's almost 4 vertical, what they call it. You're reading the free safety, throwing off him. He comes up. He knows. At that point, A.J. McCarron says, I got no safety in the middle of the field. I can lob it high. And this time, his receiver makes the play. Started with the fumble, though.
And here's the fumble recovery caused by Collins, recovered by Collins, and A.J. McCarron with his 74th career touchdown pass. All right, Tim, thank you. 14-7 after the first turnover of the game, recovered by Landon Collins. And take a look at the blocking on this touchdown.
Yeah, this is what makes it work. It's 6-on-6, 4-man rush, 2 linebackers. Watch the fits right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 different fits. That allows A.J. to dodge it. Nice block by T.J. Yeldon. No safety in the middle. And finally, a receiver helps out. That's how you do it. Turnover, pick up the blitz, throw the touchdown pass.
After starting 3-of-7, McCarron has now hit his last 6 passes. We've made the point, 36-2 as a starter. The 2 losses, 9-6 in overtime at home to LSU, and a year ago at home
to Texas A&M. You think he doesn't play well on the road?
He plays well. You got it.
Wow.
Plays pretty good at home, too.
Yeah. This one, a deep kick, touchback. Trey Mason. Well, it's time now for the Aflac trivia question of the week.
Aflac.
If you are either an Alabama or an Auburn fan, you got this one right away. Which four Alabama cities have hosted the Iron Bowl? Now, if you live in Cheyenne, you maybe not know this. But we'll have the answer shortly. First game played here between these two was 1989. They played in Birmingham for much of the time. And Paul Bryant famously said, I'm not going to go down. I'd rather play Texas 10 times than go down and play that Cal College. They played here in 89. Pat Dye was the coach. And he said getting Alabama to play here was like tearing down the Berlin Wall. This is Trey DePriest on Ricardo Lewis.
Boy, Auburn swore they were going to stick with the running game and not try to finesse Alabama, and they've come out of their shell a bit. I'm surprised.
Gus Malzahn. By the way, that's double bubble, estimated by somebody that he chews 25 pieces per game.
You know, the interesting thing about this matchup, you were talking about it, since 1989, when they did play that first game here, the series is 12-12.
Right.
This is the 25th game. So pretty even. That's you don't have a good rivalry if it's not pretty even.
Second down, 13. Play action, Marshall. Deep down the middle. And that one's going to be overthrown. It was intended for Sammy Coates, who's got such great speed. Made a big one earlier. Ha-ha, Clinton Dix defending. Third and 13.
One of the things I've talked about, when if you're going to beat Alabama, they're the champs. It's like a heavyweight champ. You have to be able to take a punch and punch back. Now, Auburn started out. Alabama was the tighter team. Now, Auburn has taken the punch.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to see if they can punch back now.
It's third and 13. They are one of five. Three of five, I beg your pardon, on third down conversions. Four down, they bring five. Stunts, Marshall, ankle tackle for a loss. Adrian Hubbard, number 42, made the tackle.
Well, in 2012, Auburn gave up 37 sacks. This year, they're doing well. They're third in the SEC with fewest sacks. But they've always been running the ball. Now they've got into a game here where they're trying to finesse Alabama with those first down passes, getting in third and long, and not being able to hold up.
Now, here is a study in strengths as well. Special teams. Stephen Clark, with only four returned this year. Christian Jones is back. He has returned two for touchdowns. And he's going to let this one bounce. So that punt return coverage average for Auburn continues to be excellent. Let's go back to the studio for this Ford update. Here's Tim Brando.
Well, we were talking, Vern, about Baylor being the Cinderella story of the season, but right now TCU is struggling, has the lead. Trayvon Boykin to Ladarius Brown, 21 yards. Horned Frogs lead at 17-13 over the once-beaten Baylor Bears. Back to you.
Thank you, Tim. First down and 10. Alabama.
Here's that unbalanced formation that they've ran two big running plays from right up the tackles for Auburn.
Yeldon is the running back, three to the wide right side. Yeldon goes left.
It's three of them.
Yep.
That formation is giving Auburn problems.
Why do you think?
I have no idea. It has to be something new for Auburn. Remember, we talked to Ellis Johnson. He said, we're very concerned about getting outflanked. Well, three times Alabama has been in this formation. They haven't even tried to outflank them.
Ellis Johnson is a defensive coordinator here for Auburn. Twice he has served on the staffs at Alabama, a total of 8 years. So he has a wonderful perspective, does Ellis Johnson, on this rivalry. Blitz, play action, McCarron, short man again. Amari Cooper, incomplete.
Had a chance.
second and 10.
Well, let's see if D. Ford can make up for his other mistake early jumping off sides. I'm still not sure Alabama would have gone for that fourth and 7. He has not made an impact in this game yet, except for his penalty.
D. Ford has 8 sacks, leads the Auburn Tigers, number 30. Lined up against Austin Shepherd. Shepherd, that's tipped, and it's caught by Norwood. Now he's loose inside the 30.
Wow. I'll be darned. And I bet A.J. has a smile because he said, when we were visiting with him a few weeks ago, he said, somehow the ball always finds Kevin Norwood.
Yeah.
And here, the ball found him again, just out of the fingertips of Chris Frost. It's a huge series for the Auburn football team. Remember, Alabama won the toss, elected to receive, which means Auburn gets the ball to start the second half.
First and 10 after Kevin Norwood's catch. Kenny Bell is on the field for the first time. He's a speedster, number 7. They run the reverse with Amari Cooper. O.J. Howard with a huge block. And Cooper,
wow,
diving for the end zone. Did he get in?
They're calling it a touchdown. They said he's the most skilled they've had since Julio Jones, but his foot, I think his hand might have come out of bounds before the ball. Watch his left hand go out of bounds and touch the ground. Where's the football?
Ooh.
It's going to be, if it's not a touchdown, it's going to be inches short.
What an athletic move, huh?
Unbelievable.
The previous ruling of a touchdown is under further review.
If it's not a touchdown, it's going to be 2-3 inches. Look at this move.
Foot's inbound, that's
yep,
for sure.
Hand goes down. Is the ball across the plane? If not, it's inches away.
All it's got to do is break that front edge.
And remember, we don't have a camera right now down this line, this long run. Let's see if we got one down the line now at the same time.
There it is.
Hand down. Right there, ball looks to me like it's touching it to me.
I think so, too.
I think that's a touchdown.
Yep. Front edge of the football needs
yep,
to break the plane.
That's, and that's all you got to do.
All it needs to do, exactly. Yep. And there's the ball, and it's almost simultaneous.
Boy, that's like Kentucky Derby, isn't it?
Yes.
A nose. Boy, it happens so, it's inches.
Yep.
But remember, it has to be irrefutable. It's been called a touchdown on the field.
You know, until they started using replay in football, I never used the word irrefutable.
The acceleration by Cooper on that play, I guess that toe's okay.
Yeah. Bothered him, particularly the first part of the year. And we wait for the review. Here's a call.
After review, the runner's hand touched down out of bounds short of the goal line. Therefore, the ball will be placed inside the one where it will be first and goal.
Look down the line. Again.
Well,
well.
It's close. We will say that.
Yeah.
It's Thanksgiving. Let's be nice to everybody, right?
You had 24 at your house. First and goal. Yeldon is the running back. Vogler will lead the way. Yeldon. Touchdown, Alabama.
Boy, it was hit right in the backfield that time. It was almost a play made.
And they are reviewing yet again to see. The call was a touchdown.
Javier Mitchell, number 16, almost got in the backfield to stop it, but okay, your turn
at
on this
ready
one,
for play on the previous play, neither clock started on time. The game clock will be set at 3:48.
So they apparently were not reviewing it. It was a matter of clocks working or not working. Touchdown. And Cade Foster out of McCarron's hold for the extra point.
Hey, you got to give Alabama offensive coordinator Doug Nussmeier a real kudos on that play sequence. Gave Auburn a little bit of everything. Remember the unbalanced line? He gashed him.
Yeah.
Passing play, a tip ball was key. How ironic is that? And then the speed and athleticism of Cooper.
Well, let's take another look at Amari Cooper on that end around. He gets that big block from Howard. There's Quanjo diving. It was called a touchdown. It was overruled. It was inconsequential, as it turns out. Touchdown, Alabama. Now you want to talk about sexy. Cue the duck. And the Aflac trivia answer, which four Alabama cities have hosted the Iron Bowl? Here you go. Auburn, Birmingham, Montgomery, about an hour away from Auburn and Tuscaloosa. The first game played in Tuscaloosa was in 2000. And that was a 9-0 Auburn victory. Another good question. Bear Bryant's won 19 of these things. Did Chuck Jordan, for whom this field is named in part, was second in wins, 9. Who was number 3? He's here today.
Oh, well, I know the end. Tommy Tuberville.
Yeah, there's no prize at the end of this.
Okay.
Tuberville won 7 out of 10 as the coach
just
of Auburn.
I knew it. That's all.
6 in a row. Trey Mason with the return out near the 18-yard line.
Remember we said the matchup of the game in my mind, what my guess of the key to the game was, who will impose their dominance? Will it be the run game for Auburn or the run-stopping game for Alabama? Look at that second quarter. It just felt like Auburn didn't commit to the run. One thing they told us is that they were going to commit to the run and that people gave up too quickly against Alabama. I thought they tried to finesse Alabama too much in that second quarter.
21 unanswered now for Alabama. They were down 7-0 in the early going. There's Uzuma. That's Mason over right guard into the arms of Trey DePriest with the tackle. 3:32 to go, and Auburn is out of timeouts.
See, look at that positive play. Just mashing up there. Trust your offensive line.
First down. Breaks a tackle. Breaks another. Caught from behind by Jonathan Allen, number 93.
You know, Alabama's known, as we've said, as one of the best tackling teams in college football, but the backs for Auburn make people miss.
That was a 42-yard gain. Here's another gallop for Trey Mason.
And I'll tell you, they'll roll it and run plays. Kirby and Gus matching up these two teams.
Marshall, he's angry at the officials because they want to go quickly.
Right, but they had to get a spot. Gus will hurry him up. Try to react and change the defense.
See, Malzahn on the right, but they hadn't moved the chains yet. They hand it off to Mason for the third time.
And he'll go fast again because he got more than 5 yards on that play. Watch him start. He'll start to point and roll it.
Gus Malzahn, second down, 4. 2:25 to go, first half. Mason again. Jonathan Allen, seeing a lot of action today, makes the stop. Third down, 3. Substitutions now for Kirby Smart and the Alabama defense.
And once Auburn substitutes, that'll allow Alabama to substitute. The umpire will stand over the ball. But the run game has saved Auburn.
Mason out. Artis Payne seeing action. Here's Marshall. Directs his blockers.
That should be a touchdown. It is.
Now that's Auburn football. Start out with a run, break some tackles, and that time did the ball get passed? He puts it into his right hand. All you got to do is break the plane.
New holder for Auburn, Stephen Clark. They're going to review the play. Nick Marshall, second touchdown on the ground in this one, first from 45.
I wonder, did he go out of bounds or did he get the ball passed into the end zone?
Certainly his feet are in bounds.
Yes. Now, did the football get inside? Remember, there's an imaginary line that runs up the field.
Just a matter of breaking the plane.
Yep. Remember, we're just showing you another thing from before when Auburn. There's the plane, and it goes up from there. All you have to do is break the front edge of that line.
This was the game at Texas A&M, and to a person, the Auburn Tigers believe that win on the road at A&M really solidified their season.
Right down the line.
Looks good to me. But we're one for one up here today. One and one.
Now, if you put the two together, the one from behind, that it's inside, because obviously the football went past the line eventually. But it, when it went past the line, was it inside the pylon? I think it's a touchdown.
After review, the runner jumped out of bounds at the two-yard line. The ball crossed at the one. Therefore, it'll be placed at the one where it'll be first and goal.
I'm 0 for 2. Yeah. I'm having a bad day.
Yeah.
Too much turkey. I thought the ball broke the plane.
Boy, so did I.
Well, Alabama overcame the call and scored.
Gus Malzahn's looking up at the Jumbotron again. Well, first and goal at the two.
At the one.
At the one, I'm sorry. Yep. Reese Dismukes over the ball. His brother Jonah played for Gene Stallings and Mike DeBose at Alabama. There's number 50, Dismukes. No snap. They feed it to Trey Mason. Touchdown.
So both calls proved to be inconsequential.
Right.
That's about as two of the closest ones that I've seen. How about Trey Mason on that drive? Breaking tackles, his big run. And then he finishes it off. I guess. Maybe.
That's
somehow.
The dressing to go with the turkey.
Yes.
Well, recall that Ryan White, normally the holder. Here's Pagan being helped off the field defensively for Alabama. And we were mentioning injuries. Ryan White was kneed in the head earlier in the ballgame. He is normally the holder for Auburn, and Stephen Clark has taken his place. There's Trey Mason. Dad is a rap star.
How about this, Vern? Auburn went into this quarter on their average with 81 yards rushing in the quarter.
Right.
On this drive, they rushed for 81 yards. So they're right on their average again. And I thought the number was right around 200 was the number that Auburn had to get to make this a game.
Well, they're at 162.
Yep. Run down by Nick Marshall. I thought Adrian Hubbard guessed on the play. Here's the end of it. The two plays. The ball's across and in. I'll argue for a while. I thought that was a touchdown. And I think it's clearly inside the line and over the line at the same time. But on the next play, Trey Mason says it didn't matter.
So Auburn counters. It's 21-14, 1:40 to go.
That was the end of the play, but at the beginning of the play, I thought Adrian Hubbard lost his discipline. Outside linebacker, I thought he went for the dive too quickly. Watch Hubbard right here just commit to the dive right away. Crashes in, one false step by Trey DePries, and he can't catch the 4-4 Marshall.
This is the squib kick. Bounces once, picked up by Christian Jones. And he doesn't get much. So the Crimson Tide gets it with 93 seconds to go before the break and one timeout. And a player down for Auburn.
Is it Javier Mitchell again?
Yes, it is. Uh-huh. Check the middle of the screen. Number 16. There, his helmet did come off as he was falling down as a part of the tackle on Christian Jones. Time has been taken. Here's the good news. Javier Mitchell holding his head. They were looking at his neck, but he is walking off by himself. Leads Alabama.
Scholarship players on this Auburn team are from the state of Alabama. And remember, the last 2 years, the score has been 93-14, and those 14 points weren't scored by the offense. Today, all 14 have been scored by the offense.
McCarron play fake comes to his right. He will tuck it and run. Looks for blocking help. He's pushed from behind by Jerome Whitehead. That stops the clock. The Geico halftime report. We'll go back to New York. Tim, Spencer, and Brian. Tim had quite a travel adventure after doing the game in Baton Rouge yesterday. A thrilling ball game. The old missed the flight routine.
No, that's never fun. Remember, if Barrett Jones was calling plays here, he loves the screen in the situation. Remember that?
Yep. Second and three. Yeldon. See where the spot is made. 1:15 to go. Nosa Igwe with the tackle. One of the seniors for this Auburn team.
They could get a quick snap and a penalty right here. Too many men on the field.
Oh, no. There's two flags.
It's going to be too many men on the field for Auburn. And Auburn could not take a timeout. They didn't have any left.
Right.
Illegal substitution on the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. First out.
So Gus Malzahn say what happened.
Yeah. Two guys where they were trying to substitute in short yardage defense, and Alabama went hurry up, no huddle.
Again, Auburn with no timeout. There's the late sub and the snap. Now on first down and 10, McCarron out of the spread. Low snap, picked up by McCarron, steps up. Nobody open, shovels it, and it's behind T.J. Yeldon, 55 seconds to go.
But at least it stops the clock, and he doesn't get sacked.
Nosa Igwe, number 94, a senior from Mansfield, a suburb of Dallas.
Yeah, he was matched up against Anthony Steen that time. Ironic, because those are the only two guys on the teams that started the 2010 game. Igwe and Steen, and they're matched up against each other a lot in this football game.
Auburn brings four straight.
There's
rush.
The screen. You knew
and
it was coming.
Is down.
I think Quanjo, left tackle, moved early. You knew the screen was coming. It's just an MO for Alabama's two-minute drill.
False start. 71 offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Number 71, big guy right there. Just leans back.
Mm-hmm. Quanjo, Cyrus, and his brother Ari, the left side of the Alabama offensive line. Second and 15. Draw play. Yeldon. Caught and dropped. Jeremy Jones, Jonathan Jones, number three.
Alabama took a timeout here. Third and long.
Yep. Timeout. Third and 14. Yeldon stopped by Jonathan Jones, number three. Welcome back. What a scene. First winner-take-all Iron Bowl ever. The winner of this one goes to Atlanta and a spot in the SEC championship game. Possibilities then for a BCS title game. It's 21-14 and third and 14. Both teams now without a timeout. McCarron is 10 of 16. They will keep it on the ground. Yeldon upended by Ryan Smith, number 24.
I thought that was a great call by Alabama. If they pop it and get a first down, obviously the clock will stop. If it doesn't get a first down, they can ride out the half and not have to punt. Well, both teams, after that last drive by Auburn, when Auburn went back to running the ball, I think have to be mildly pleased. Alabama withstood the start of this game, and Auburn got punched and got up and punched back.
Well, here is a note we always seem to add when we're doing an Alabama game. Under Nick Saban, Alabama is 73-3 when leading at the half. And let's go down to Tracy, who is with the Auburn coach, Gus Malzahn.
Thanks a lot. And coach, Alabama seemed to find their rhythm there, but a huge touchdown drive. What kind of statement was that in terms of making that going into half?
Yeah, that was big. You know, once we get an initial first down and we can play fast, you know, we play pretty good. So that's going to be the key the second half.
Well, your team has found ways to win in the second half in the fourth quarter. How much will you bring that up going into the locker room?
Yeah, that's big. You know, if it's a close game in the fourth quarter, I like our chances.
Thanks a lot. Vern?
All right, Gus Malzahn. He was the offensive coordinator here for 3 years, including a national championship season under a fellow named Cam Newton. Let's go back to Tim in New York.
All right, Vern, thank you.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the GEICO Halftime Report. I'm Tim Brando with the score on the Plains. Alabama leading Auburn 21-14, joined by Spencer Tillman and Brian Jones. Fellas, for me, the turning point of this game had to be Landon Collins forcing that fumble in the second quarter. It really sort of turned the game after Auburn really had some missed opportunities early on.
Yeah, I think it's the first time these two teams are meeting as top five opponents, guys. And so there's bound to be some emotion connected to this. The key is not to let that affect your execution. I think early on, we saw some of that. But first, let's flash back a little bit to what happened a couple of weeks ago. You remember this, the epic play that set up this unbelievable matchup that we have today? Nick Marshall to Ricardo Lewis here. Excellent execution in a pressure context. Again, a chance to write another line in that destiny narrative. Comes up a little short. Probably the quarterback's culpable there. Yep. That's an adjustable ball. If it touches your hand, BJ, right. I'm of the opinion you got to catch that. Right. Ultimately, the go-ahead happens a little bit later on, and they're playing catch-up since that point.
Exactly. And you look at Alabama on the flip side. They came out, and they were a little discombobulated. Defensively, they weren't aligned correctly. You had guys running onto the field, running off to the field, as you see there, weren't making it adjustments, and next thing you know, you're getting gassed. Corey Grant here to start the game, the former Bama player. Here once again, guys not lined up correctly. You're doing all this pointing before the ball is snapped. That lets me know you're not sure of what your assignment is. And here, you know, C.J. Mosley falling his key to back leaves a huge hole in that defense. Nick Marshall exploits it. Next thing you know, he's in the end zone.
That last touchdown, though, for Auburn means game on coming in the second half. Now let's get to action. Highlight blitz run.
Of Rob Bramlett of Auburn and Eli Gold of Alabama, a couple of the special voices in college football. Let's go down to Tracy.
You seem to have gained your rhythm there, but then you let up a big drive. What happened?
Well, we just didn't play very well in defense. They ran a counter on us three times in a row. We never closed and spilled it. So we just got to execute better. And, you know, offensively, we got to throw and catch the ball better. And, you know, everybody's got to do their job. That's what it comes down to. And we haven't played with the kind of energy and enthusiasm we need to win a game like this.
Thanks a lot.
All right, Tracy, thank you. With Nick Saban. And if you remember back when we started, Alabama won the toss, opened with possession of the football. So it goes to the Auburn Tigers, who put the plug in 21 unanswered by Alabama with that last touchdown drive, to which Nick Saban just referred. The kick from Foster. Taken at the goal line. Here's Mason to the 30. Well, it was a significant drive, obviously, by Auburn to open, to end the first half. How significant is this opening drive?
Well, the last one was bigger. I have to admit that. But, right. I mean, I think the matchup is what it is. We can be fancy, spend 2 weeks on it. If Auburn runs the ball against Alabama, they got a chance to win. And remember, when Alabama wins the turnover margin, they win. The six games that they've lost, the last six SEC games that they've lost, they did not win the turnover margin. The difference in the game is the turnover so far.
Alabama did score off that turnover. Here's Marshall up the middle. C.J. Mosley is there. DePriest was in the neighborhood to help.
Just get the feeling that no matter how many times Auburn likes to show you they're going to run wide and they have to do it to keep Alabama honest, the yards have been made between the tackles.
Exactly. That was a pickup of 7, second down and 3. Uzama goes in motion. Marshall keeps it this time. He does go wide. Spins in tight.
Look at that move.
Yes, indeed. Jerick Williams with the tackle.
Fooled us a bit, but how can you blame him? Landon Collins spins one way, and Marshall spins the other way.
And a first down 10 for the Auburn Tigers, trailing by 7. Mason skips outside, turns the corner. Collins shoves him out of bounds. And Gary, let's take a look at the halftime trends.
Well, as Nick said, I think he's right. You know, it's the little things that you got to do. A.J. did not start off sharp. He did finish sharp. Nick Marshall made that big 45-yard run that shocked him. You can see the game kind of unfolding exactly the way we kind of guessed.
Marshall flips it out.
Third option. I'm right there.
Right. Quan Bray, who scoots down the sidelines and is out of bounds at the 35.
And they'll get faster and faster now while Auburn.
Here they go. On the made first down, they go as quickly as they can.
And they'll go fast because they're at the near hash where they can get their players substituted quicker as well.
Mason up the middle. Adrian Hubbard with the tackle on this one.
So Gus will run the trigger from one sideline. Kirby Smart will try to get his guys adjusted from the other sideline.
Second down 5. Marshall, quick flip out to the left side. It's Bray again.
He's down to the 20.
He's got him right now. Second and short. Gus will roll it. He will roll it. See it roll it? And because it's read plays, they can run the same play over and over again because there's different options off of it.
Left side. Trey Mason well over 100 yards already.
Yep, and he'll roll it again. Nick will be pointing. And now you got to say the whole stands understand what's going on. Brandon, big nose tackles.
Yeah, Brandon Ivory is down. Melzon have a pretty good sense of what he's saying.
Yep. It's hit in the back of the head. I did not see him look to the bench at all to kind of get a signal. I did not see anything there where he was given a signal.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't have been a bad move, to tell you the truth. A little bit unethical, but he also could be hurt.
Well, if you're Jason Kidd, you just say, hit me, and you spill water in the court.
50 grand later.
And then you pay $50,000. Sammy Coates. Darren Lake has taken Brandon Ivory's place.
Now, remember, the key now with this drive rolling, Gus will continue to go fast. Remember, this part of the field is where he loves C.J. Uzuma, number 81.
First down, 10.
Much tougher job for Kirby Smart to get those signals in.
There's Mason alongside Marshall. Marshall fakes the toss, keeps it, hauled down from behind by Ed Stinson, number 49. And take a look now at the Auburn red zone stats provided by Verizon. See, just a little bit above the national average, 69% touchdowns inside the 20. Second and 8. 21-14, opening drive, third quarter.
Coach to the top, up there.
Marshall drills it.
Uzuma.
Touchdown, Auburn.
They love the tight ends. Number 18 and 81. They love the tight ends and the big receivers in the red zone. He's up against Aaron Jones. Hitch and go. A little bit of a grab, but a perfect throw. What a drive by Auburn.
That's Uzuma's eighth catch of the year. But his third touchdown. And Auburn within an extra point try of tying it up.
Uzuma, high school quarterback, 6'4". Jones, maybe 5'10".
Cody Parkey, 50 of 51 this year, and there's a mess in the middle.
Offside, defense 95. That penalty's declined. We'll attempt the try.
Darren Lake.
If you ever wanted to take a clinic drive of the Gus Malzahn offense, just put on that tape for the first drive of the third quarter.
So they score the last touchdown of the first half and the first touchdown of the second half. And we are notched at 21.
Well, I said they love the tight end Uzuma down at this side of the field. Sammy Coates up here, Uzuma down there, both good-sized receivers. He could have gone either way. He chose the bottom, catch and go. More physical and a wonderful throw.
21-21 in the winner-take-all Iron Bowl. Team 1-all. opening drive of the third quarter. Look at the previous two games combined against the Crimson Tide, 170. Already 200 yards on the ground against a team that gives up only 91 per game.
You know, and in the 2010 win with Cam Newton, it wasn't the running game that worked that game. It was Cam throwing the ball. This is new territory for this offense versus Alabama.
Here is the kick. And this, not unexpected from the number one kickoff touchback leader. That's an uncomfortable way of saying it, but Cody Parkey knocks it through the park. And now Red Lobster presents today's scholar athlete. It's Alex Kozan, left guard for Auburn. Red Lobster's commitment to the investment of our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to Auburn University's general scholarship fund. There's Kozan. He and the guys up front have been bulldozers today.
So what does Alabama answer? Remember, this is only the second time all year in the third quarter they've been tied. 17-17 LSU. Remember, they went power football.
Yeldon is the running back, and he'll get the handoff. Shepard with a good block on the edge, and Yeldon with a nice pickup out to the 30-yard line. Here's a note. That's a five-yard gain. That puts them at 141 yards rushing. Since 2008, Alabama is 60-0 when rushing for 140 or more yards. They're tied here.
Here's that on-balance formation. They've got it flanked to left this time.
Norwood comes in to help block.
They've run in. They jumped outside. They're going to run inside again, though.
Looks like O.J. Howard moved.
Prior to the snap, false start, 88 offense. Five-yard penalty, still second down.
I think Nick's interview with Tracy was telling again. You know, he's reputed to not say much, but he says a lot in his interviews. He was upset with the way his team played in the first half, just making the normal plays. There's another one right there.
Second and nine. McCarron short, caught by Yeldon, tackled, gang tackle. Gabe Wright with the lead, number 90.
Well, I wondered if this Auburn bit undersized defensive line could stand up to the punishment. They've been doing it. You got to give that front group. It's hard to wear them down because they play so many in the front four. They go about 10 deep. They have been fresh, and they're not wore down.
Third and 10. 1 of 6 today for Alabama. Three-man rush. McCarron shakes the tackle, pulls up and throws it away. Punting situation. D Ford with pressure.
Well, they initially rushed three and then brought a linebacker, but I think it was D Ford right here that put the pressure on McCarron. But after he shook loose from D Ford, he really had nowhere to go with the ball. Covered, covered, covered. Nowhere to throw the football at all. Get rid of it, and he did. A great defensive stand for Auburn. That second down penalty was huge.
Yes. Cody Mandel on to punt. And this is Chris Davis, who will take it at the 23. How about that downfield coverage? Wow. DeAndre White, wide receiver, a 52-yard punt. Nada on the return.
It's time now for today in Auburn football history.
And Auburn having tied it up. There's DeAndre White. What a secure special teams tackle. Prior to that, maybe he's signaling for a fair catch.
Flavor.
Trey Mason, the running back for Auburn, already with 123 yards. It is his fourth 100-yard-plus running effort this season.
We were talking to offensive coordinator Rhett Lashley about Trey Mason. He said, oh, yeah, he was a highly recruited running back. We knew he was good. He's strong, very committed, very elusive, tough to tackle, very strong legs, and he's putting on a show here. This whole offense earned the last two drives by Auburn. 9 plays, touchdown. 18 plays for over 150 yards, averaging over 8 yards per play the last two drives.
And they have a first down 10 and a tie game at the 22. Marshall up the middle, look at him, elusive, with a big gain on first down. Alex Kozan with the lead block.
He sure did. Fitted really nicely, didn't he? And whose name have we not called much tonight? C.J. Mosley. Couple plays early, but he's been mesmerized. They're running around him and through him, and they're blocking him.
Marshall takes off left. Down, he's out of bounds.
Look at him get the corner, though.
Yep.
When he was being recruited, the scouting report on Nick Marshall was an elite athlete, basketball and football, and they projected Nick Marshall to be a Champ Bailey-type corner for Georgia.
Well, he asked Mike Bobo, the offensive coordinator at Georgia, if he could play defensive back because he thought his chances were better to play both sports. Corey Grant with his third carry.
Okay, you know, that didn't work. But in this offense, that's like a long, incomplete pass in a passing offense. Auburn has to continue to do that to continue to stretch Alabama. Most of their yards are between the tackles. Got to give credit. Dismukes, Kozan, Slade, Robinson, Young. But they have to show him enough outside to then run inside.
Mason back in. With 88 yards on the ground on 12 carries. The throw. No, he won't. Mosley hauls him down. But it's a gain of 11.
I was looking at the secondary, but did he shake Xavier Dixon first? On the first play, Mosley ended up getting the tackle, grabbing by the jersey. That's a legal play. That's not a horse collar.
It is another first down, this time at the 45 of Alabama.
I think it's third and short.
You're right. I was looking at the graphic
exactly.
up here.
Exactly. But they got it on that one now. You were just anticipating it, that's all. You were
I was.
Yeah,
it's a look at the field, Lundquist.
Well, no, that I just trying to help out, but they got it rolling again, don't they?
Yep, thank you. Mason.
See those plays, there's nothing bothers Alabama more. They'd rather sometimes give up a deep pass than to have somebody march the ball on the ground. It breaks them. They have their pride in stopping the run.
This time it's out to the left, and the tackle is made. Quan Bray, Deion Blue is right there.
Yeah, great read that time. But again, part of the offense that continues to have to be run. It's part of the triple option offense that they run from Malzahn's offense. Talk to Nick Saban about it. He goes, you know, Gus never was a big zone read guy until he got Nick Marshall, because Nick Marshall's better on the edges. Cam used to be better between the tackles.
Right. Third down, 9. Uzuma in motion. Alabama looks like they'll bring 5. They bring 6. Sidearm throw. It'll be short. Denzel Duvall, number 30, leading the tackling brigade. Nice one.
Well, you can see the athletes at Alabama, when they figure out who has the ball, they're pretty quick to it, aren't they?
Well, the Alabama, the end is here. Stephen Clark is on to punt. This will be his third of the game. Christian Jones hoping for an opportunity to return it. Forrest Hill will snap it back on 4th and 11. Look at this. Look at this.
I think it was Sammy Coates, the wide receiver. He camped under that baby and got the bounce right to him. A lot of bounces, long bounces going that direction work well for Auburn in this stadium.
Stephen Clark, 42-yard punt. Nothing on the return. Yesterday, we saw LSU with a backup quarterback go 99 yards to defeat Arkansas. Well, here's an opportunity to break a tie for Alabama. At the one. Yeldon. Perhaps 3 yards.
Auburn's coaching staff believes that this is not as physical of Alabama offensive line that they faced in the last 4 years. It's up to Auburn's defensive line to prove that right now. Can they stop it or not?
Second down, 8.
Second down is when Alabama loves to run those little play-action passes out of the end zone. Will they try to get Charleston Fowler out there on the edge?
That's Fowler in motion. He'll line up just to the right of McCarron. Yeldon, nothing. Robinson, Therese, number 27.
Yeah, Ryan Smith and Therese. Remember, Auburn runs a 4-2-5. Ryan Smith, a safety, guesses, and Robinson Therese answers the other side of it. They believe they can take the physical game to this Alabama offensive line, does Auburn.
Third and 8, D Ford, left side, matched up against Austin Shepherd. McCarron, 2 yards into the end zone. McCarron deep, right side, man open, Amari Cooper. Wow.
You don't win back-to-back championships by being the finesse football team. Watch this offensive line handle a pass rush. Ellis Johnson goes four-man line. It gets stoned. Bad coverage in the back end. Ryan White took a poor angle, and A.J. McCarron hung in the pocket and made the biggest throw of the game so far.
That was a gain of 54 and a first down 10, only the second third down conversion for the Crimson Tide.
It's a great football game, isn't it?
Oh, my goodness. Yeldon, nothing. Ryan Smith, number 24.
You see safeties on back-to-back plays making tackles at the line of scrimmage. When is Alabama going to give them that crossing, that deep crossing play-action pass where those guys go way across? Remember those plays? We've been seeing them for 8 years.
Well, there are 4.8 residents of Alabama. Half of them will greet you by saying War Eagle. The other half will say Roll Tide. We just say we're Switzerland. We're neutral. But it's great fun to be a part of it.
All of them don't believe that.
Second nine. McCarron tries to get the first down and get out of bounds, and he appears, well, let's see. Looks like he made it.
I saw an interview he did with Kirk Herbstreit today, A.J. McCarron. And he said, do you bristle a little bit when they call you a game manager? And he said, I do. He said, it's not that easy doing what I have to do. All the pressure to play the position, make the plays at the right time and the key time. What he's doing here right now is vintage A.J. McCarron.
DeAndre White, top of the screen. First down and 10. 3 minutes to go, third quarter.
Got one-on-one coverage to the top.
Play action.
There's the crossing play action.
Christian Jones is the safety valve. And he's got it on the little wheel route to the right side. Ryan Smith with the tap.
Well, you knew it was coming, wasn't it? The play action pass.
Second.
And again on first down, the play isn't there that was called. Dump it off to the back. Give me second and short.
Cyrus Quanjo, Ari Quanjo go to the right. Lindsay is the center. Steen, Shepard on the right side, Vogler the tight end, and three receivers to the left.
On balance formation again, where are they going to run it inside?
Blitz. Yeldon goes around the corner.
They bounced it out, didn't he?
Yes. Chris Davis with the tackle. Stops the clock with 2:02 to go, third quarter. See the drive charts. They started at the one. Five runs, two passes so far. First and 10 at the 22.5. Low snap. McCarron picks it up, goes in the end zone. He's got a man open and he drops it. Amari Cooper had both hands on it.
I think Jonathan Mincy might have stripped it. I'm
really
not sure. One-on-one coverage. Vern called to the low snap. Mincy gets turned around. Does he come back in? And I'm not sure if he dropped it or not. I cannot tell. No, he dropped it before Mincy got there. Another drop ball by the Alabama receiving corps tonight. Thought he had a touchdown, did McCarron.
Second down, 10. Yeldon alongside Howard is in the slot. Now Yeldon comes in motion to the left. Four-man rush inside. DeAndre White.
Flag here.
Wow. On the near side.
I wonder if they're saying Alabama was not set. It's the only thing I can think of.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense. All 11 players failed to come to a stop.
They were not
the
set. That's what I thought.
5-yard penalty. Still second down.
This guy and this guy are moving at the same time. Not at once. They got to have 1 second in between when one guy goes in motion and then another guy goes in motion. Part of that is A.J. McCarron's fault. It's his foot that starts T.J. Yeldon in motion.
Second down, 15. Another low snap. McCarron, safety valve. Oh, my goodness, it's Norwood again.
What a clutch player. We've been doing Alabama games, you know, forever. It's our eighth year. But 5 years, Kevin Norwood's been on the team. And every time we meet with the coaches and talk about receivers, his name barely comes up until
it.
This year. All he does is catch passes. And clutch passes.
Always, it seems. Third and four. Norwood goes right. Bunch to the right side. Howard is off the line in the slot on third and four. Another low snap. McCarron will scramble. McCarron to...
Oh, yeah. He got the first down.
I think he did, yes.
And how big this one was for A.J. McCarron. Nobody to go through. Low snap. This Auburn defense in the fourth quarter, they only give up one out of four for third down conversions. In the second half, they also give up 27%. It's pretty close to the fourth quarter. That's a big one for Alabama.
Chad Lindsey is the center replacing the injured Ryan Kelly. He's had three low snaps in the spread. So McCarron, I'm not sure this is the cause of it. He goes under center.
Good observation.
We can handle this one. McCarron directing his traffic. Throws it into the end zone. Wow, DeAndre White.
When he let that ball go, I looked into the end zone and thought there was an Auburn player in front. There was. Whitehead was right in front of him. That was about as risky as you could get on a first down throw.
Well, the two teams will march to the south end of the stadium where this drive began. It began on the one. It's at the 10 now. We were hoping for something above average.
My.
We've got it. 21-0. We'll return to Auburn right after this word from your local station. We welcome you back to the fourth. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson, Tracy Wilson. Let's take a look at the last play as we begin the fourth quarter.
Just to show you, first down throw. White was open early, and I think that got in A.J.'s head because he got flushed out of the pocket. If he throws it right there, he had a touchdown. Then he goes back to him, and it gets very dangerous at the end. Jermaine Whitehead actually overruns the interception. Watch this. Oh, my goodness.
So a narrow escape for the Crimson Tide. This is the 12th play of the drive. It's second down and 10 at the 11 in a tie game. Winner take all.
And what do you do if you're Auburn? The last time they blitzed, Alabama picked it up. I don't think they'll do it again.
That's Amari Cooper. Sets up on the left side. He comes back to the right. A.J. McCarron finds him as a safety valve.
They played soft. They played soft.
Robinson Therese, number 27.
Good call by Ellis Johnson. Remember they blitzed. We showed all six Alabama players picking up the blitz. Touchdown to Norwood. This time Ellis Johnson says no way.
Third and 10 in the tie game. Winner goes to Atlanta. McCarron steps up under pressure, fires it in the end zone over Christian Jones' head. And that'll leave it up to Cade Foster, who has missed one today.
Successful drive by Alabama as we watch this last play. Auburn adjusts. They are not going to come after him. Safety standing in the end zone, and A.J. puts it where only his guy might have a chance for it. Remember, so this drive started at the one. So what a great drive for Alabama.
Foster missed earlier from 44. This will be from 28 to break the tie in the Iron Bowl.
It's whistled. They stopped it.
There was a fly.
Hey! Prior to the snap, false start. 77 offense. 5-yard penalty.
Well, that's Ari Quanjo. And one of those little things.
Yep.
Where was that?
I didn't see it. It went unbalanced line to the left that time. He was actually the right guard on that time.
So now a 33-yard effort from the right hash for Cade Foster, a senior out of Southlake, suburb of Dallas-Fort Worth. Oh, boy.
Little things turn into huge things.
I must say, if there was movement on the successful field goal from Ari Quanjo, it was imperceptible.
Hooked bad, wasn't it? Didn't even get it up in the air.
Well, I don't want to put too much on his shoulders. Take a look at the penalty.
I think he was right there, the right guard. I didn't see him move at all.
That's 0 for 2. Mel's on. Boom!
Get back to Vern and Gary at the Iron Bowl.
All right. Missed field goal from Cade Foster, 33 yards out. His second miss today.
The umpire is looking right at Quanjo, right there. Number 77 moves over to right guard. Watch him just bobble. He's staring right at him. Just a little bit of that bobble. It was called. It was the correct call.
Let's go down to Tracy.
Well, guys, Nick Saban obviously not happy with that movement by Quandro. He came over to the offensive line, and he said, who moved? Quandro just looked at him. He took ownership, and Nick Saban, of course, walked away in disgust, guys.
All right, Tracy, thank you. And for Cade Foster, as Gary just said during the break, Groundhog Day.
Well, he's had this nightmare before, hasn't he?
1 of 4 in the game of the century for that year, at least. That was LSU's win over Alabama, 9-6 in overtime. Down the sidelines, Corey Grant.
Well, Corey Grant is from Opelika High School, right near here, Auburn University. He was going to sign with Auburn. Tommy Tuberville was fired. Signed with Alabama. Said my heart's at Auburn. Transferred back. And now he's out here playing.
He's one of several who had an Auburn / Alabama decision to make. Here's Marshall. Wow. C.J. Mosley missed.
Two misses on that play. I think it was Stinson, or was it Hubbard? It was Hubbard and Mosley first.
It was Hubbard, yes, number 42. This one is stuffed.
A third and very short.
Trey Mason, hit by number 42, Adrian Hubbard. Third down, one.
Third and one, tie game, 13 minutes to go in regulation. Prosh, the fullback, number 35 on the right side. They go right, Mason.
Mason carries for the first down.
Move the chain, first down 10. And Auburn wants to go quickly. Mason, 133, Marshall, 105. Alabama, first time since 2004.
Yeah, my number was between 180 and 200. Auburn had to split the difference. 90 yards given up by Alabama, 320 for them, right at 180, 200 yards. They're over that number. They're in the game.
First down, 10. Up the middle she goes. Mason again. Well, only 13 runners had exceeded 100 yards during the Nick Saban era here. Only one this year. That was Trey Edmonds of Virginia Tech in the season opener. And here we have two Auburn Tigers over 100. Second down, 7, tie game, under 12 to play.
Who would have believed? 270 yards rushing against this Alabama team. Auburn believed it, right?
Yep.
And most of it, as you saw that graphic, right between the tackles.
The 78th Iron Bowl, the passion for this game among fans of each team, unrivaled. That's going to make it a third down again. Third and 4.
Remember how loose Auburn was in the open?
Yep.
Now they look up and go, oh my goodness. We're 11 minutes away from beating Alabama and going to the SEC championship after losing 49-0 a year ago.
And 42-14 the year before that. Play action. Marshall tipped.
Yes, it was.
Incomplete. Tipped by Ed Stinson, number 49.
Now, what does Gus Malzahn do? It's in that in-between yardage area. Does he go for it or punt it?
Looks like the punting unit is coming on. Stephen Clark, who again has been superb in this game. This will be his fourth punt. Remember, he had one down at the one the last time he efforted this. Here's Christian Jones. Stephen Clark, what an effort he's made today.
And now it's time for our Geico game recap.
Six touchdowns scored in this game, the first of which off the feet of Nick Marshall, 45 yards into the end zone. Auburn up 7-0. And then 21 unanswered by Alabama. First, Jalston Fowler, touchdown from McCarron. Next, Kevin Norwood, another touchdown from McCarron, 14-7. And finally, Yeldon from 1 yard out. That gave Alabama a 14-point edge. But on the last drive of the first half, Mason from 1 yard out made it 21-14. On the first drive of the second half, Uzuma, 13 yards, tied up. And then just moments ago, Kate Foster missed it left after a 5-yard penalty. Well, we wanted a good one. Now they're at the 1 yard line. Do they have enough in the tank to move it out again?
Well, you know, everybody was wondering, will the game live up to the hype? Yes, it's lived up to the hype. Alabama, I don't think, has played his best game, but they've got a lot of experience in these tight football games. Auburn, though, after the Georgia thing a couple weeks ago.
Right.
Who cares?
They believe. Ha! Amen. From the one. Play action, McCarron. How about this decision? Going deep, Amari Cooper is there. Has it loose down the right side. There are no flags, and that is a 99-yard touchdown. McCarron Cooper, Alabama leads.
It was an out and up. Watch him go down. Safety never gets it. Jermaine Whitehead never gets there. Last time Alabama from the one, Bernie asked me, could they do it? Yeah, I should have said yes.
Well, you give and you take. And 2 weeks ago, a 73-yard desperation heave, the prayer, Jordan-Hare. How about this? McCarron to Cooper, 99 yards, Alabama leads.
Yeah, you expect a little help here, but this guy, Mincy, got schooled. Trust the offensive line, play action pass, throw it deep. Mincy takes one false step, Whitehead doesn't get there. Those are nice. That helps your average if you're a quarterback, and it helps your opportunity to win three in a row if you're Alabama.
Amari Cooper, who's had a tough year, especially the first half of it, 1,000 yards as a freshman a year ago, now with 5 receptions for 170 yards in this one. I would suggest that you cinch up your seatbelts. We've got a lot of time left. Jordan-Hare Stadium, A.J. McCarron, 99-yard touchdown pass. Boy, he heaved it. Look at the block on D. Ford. Now watch McCarron.
Yep. Reminds you of Johnny Manziel against Alabama when he hit that long one to Mike Evans. Remember?
What a great shot that is. And now the head coach, Nick Saban. There's a pat on the rear end that's a little milder than one we remember when
and
he was a freshman.
And there's his brother.
Yep.
At the finish.
Corey McCarron. Previous long, Kitchens to Vaughn in 96. Well, that's a record that will stand, don't you think?
Yeah, it's going to be tough to break that one.
Squib kick. No, not really a squib kick. Low. Quan Bray has it. And he's tackled.
Quan Bray returns for the 6.
Don't forget later in the game, the play of the game presented by Napa Auto Parts. Well, 2 weeks ago, we were kind of unanimous that it would be Ricardo Lewis's great catch on the deflection to beat Georgia. I think right now the leader in the clubhouse just happened. 10:21 to go.
Well, here we go.
Yep.
We got a lot of time. I'm going to enjoy every part of this one. You don't beat the champ if you don't knock him out.
Cameron Otis Payne is the running back. He gets the give. And that's a nice start. Let's take a look at the few losses for Alabama.
Well, you see, since 2008, Alabama has lost six SEC games, three of them in 2010. But in all of those games, to use the common thread, they did not win the turnover battle. Tonight they are. They were outrushed in attempts at yards. Tonight they're being outrushed. But fourth quarter scoring, they haven't done it. Tonight they did so far.
Second down, six. There's a nice defensive play on Cameron Artis Payne, C.J. Mosley. Very quiet in the first three quarters, but has been a presence here recently. 9:32 to go.
Third down, five.
Under trouble. Cameron Artis Payne heaves it out.
It's close, but I think he's short.
And it appears from the spot right over the line.
Yep.
Xavier Dixon wrapped him up.
Really nice job that time. Good pressure by Alabama. Nick Marshall got out of the pocket and dropped it off.
They will bring the chain from the far side and measure this one. And let's go down to Tracy Wolfson.
Well, guys, you should see what's happening down here. They just ran into a panic. They grabbed a cord, an extension cord. They pulled out a sewing machine from their trunk here. They took out Ladarius Owens' jersey, and now they're sewing it here on the sidelines.
Tracy, I've been doing this a long time. I've never seen a sewing machine on a sideline. Only in the SEC.
You got to be prepared. Now, what is Auburn prepared to do right here? Roll the dice here and try to go fourth and short.
It appears that they will try. Fourth and one.
They're the second best rushing team in the nation. I think they should try it.
For 35, trending by 7, 8:46 to go.
Oh, they were going to gimmick it. Now they'll look around.
Ricardo Lewis is in the slot to the right side. Not a factor so far in this game. Marshall.
I think his knee was down short.
Adrian Hubbard, number 42, got there first. The ball goes over.
Adrian Hubbard, you're exactly right. As he looked at Kirby Smart, he did his job. And his job was the quarterback. Assignment football. You got the quarterback. Takes on the block from Prosh, number 35. One of the few blocks you'll see Jay miss. He overpowered the fullback and makes the tackle. What a play by Hubbard.
One more look. Alabama leads by 7, and they've got the ball at the Auburn 35-yard line. Well, the mending job continues on the Auburn sideline for Ladarius Owens. I still am stunned that there is a sewing machine. This was during the timeout. This guy's multitasking. He sewed it up. Now he's going to help him on with the jersey. I do have a button missing on my coat. I'm going to hustle down there as soon as the game's over. Look at this.
Yeah. I just got to say, doesn't the SEC make a lot of money? Can't you have backup jerseys? Wouldn't that be easier than sewing that one?
Okay, pack up your old kit bag and smile. And a reminder, the Jeep postgame code show coming up from New York. Tim Spencer, Brian, when this one is over, and it may be a while. First down, 10. The ball goes over on downs. A.J. McCarron had a 99-yard pass to Amari Cooper on the last possession.
First and 10.
We showed you the common denominator when they lose. They don't lose very often, but a great start for Alabama, getting points in the fourth quarter.
Yeldon, big hole. Nice move. They try to rip it out. He goes out and in control of the football. Gain of 13 on first down.
Well, when T.J. Yeldon follows number 77, Ari Quanjo that time. T.J. Yeldon, his teammates say he never says a word. He just focuses in on his job. He reads his keys, and his teammates say he's amazing. He never makes the wrong decision when he runs.
He's carried 19 times for 99 yards in this one, a touchdown, and it's first down and 10. Yeldon gets it again inside the 20, down at the 15. Well, that McCarron pass, everybody wants to have a defining Heisman moment if they're going to win the award.
Well,
I'm not a propagandist, but that's a pretty good one.
Well, he's got his case. I mean, his case is strong. Two straight championships, and he's got his team undefeated. Yeah, they got a good team, but I'll say this. Anybody who thinks that anybody could play quarterback and win here, that's just as wrong.
No interceptions again tonight.
Yeah, one-on-one to the outside, both wide receivers to the left. They're going to pound.
Yeah, they do. That's at the 13-yard line. Third and one. And we talked about the implications of this game. Called by some the most important Iron Bowl ever. The winner of this one will go to the SEC Championship in Atlanta next week. Missouri or South Carolina will be the opponent. Third and one. They give it to Yeldon again. He's going to be close. See where the spot is. Chris Frost made that tackle. This is going to require bringing the chain
down.
On.
No, I think it's fourth.
It's fourth, okay.
Yeah, it's short. It's short.
All righty.
Field goal or go for it again?
Foster is 0 for 2.
Well, I'd be shocked if he brings Foster in here.
Yeah.
He saw that happen before. Nick, 9-6. He'll go for it. Remember, Alabama got the stop. Can Auburn get the stop?
McCarron. Yeldon.
They did not get it. Yes, they did. Back-to-back fourth down stops. This time by the true freshman, Carl Lawson. Well, when your kicker makes you worry, you go for it. Carl Lawson comes off the block and makes the play. How about that? Number 55, a true freshman, stops the Alabama run.
One more look. Lawson right there with a jolting tackle on fourth down. Nincy Whitehead. We've got a chance.
Well, here's Carl Lawson. Alabama bus. Nobody blocks number 55. Vogler turns him loose. Fowler turns him loose. Another busted assignment by Alabama. Nick Saban decides not to go for a 35-yard field goal. Trusts his offensive line. They let him down, a missed assignment.
And so Marshall gets a chance, now 58 passing yards, 108 on the ground. First down and 10, 5:34 to go. Both teams have all three timeouts remaining. And at the 14-yard line.
Quick snap, it'll be a quick snap here.
Alabama, three down.
They bring four. Marshall in trouble. Trade to Priest. Got there. So did Ed Stinson, but give it to the linebacker.
Well, Nick Saban gambles. Kirby Smart gambles, bringing the blitz on first down. What a nice run defense there. It was a blitz rush defensive call, and Trey Dupree makes the play.
Here's Kirby Smart, defensive coordinator.
He dialed that one up, didn't he?
Loss of 9, second down and 19, 5 to go. Winner goes to Atlanta. Marshall from the end zone across the middle. It sails on an incomplete. Third and 19.
Third down.
After the sack. Get back here. Who do you think you are, Mike Tomlin?
Well, here it is, third down. Remember, Alabama's pride is their third down and long defense.
And Auburn's success 2 weeks ago was on fourth down and long. Little. Wow. Third and 19.
Remember, in this situation, you got outside of the pocket to convert last time.
They contain him here. He goes down right side. Got a man open. Incomplete, intended for Ricardo Lewis.
I think Lewis thought he had this. Geno Smith caught an earful, and that prayer was not answered in Jordan-Hare. I mean, it's just a streak down the sideline. Where was the safety? They got three deep on the play. A total bust by Geno Smith, and I thought Lewis thought he had it the whole way, just off his fingertips. Kirby Smart was like, get off the field. What are you doing? That was his outside third, and he busted again. So many mistakes by Alabama.
And despite the multitude of mistakes, they have a 7-point lead and force the punt. And it's taken by Christian Jones. He finally gets a chance to return one. And he's bumped out of bounds by the punter, Stephen Clark. A 19-yard return.
Yeah, the crowd thought there was a block in the back on this play right as he turned the corner. Christian Jones, who was the man against Virginia Tech. Punt return, kickoff return. Definite push from behind that time, wasn't there?
Yes. Not called. Another look at it. Well, this is the end of the play. Helmet to helmet on the punter.
But remember, this half, both coaches have all three of their timeouts. So a stop here is still a football game for Auburn.
T.J. Yeldon is the running back. Goes left.
And this Auburn defensive line is hanging in there. One of the things that I talked about is it's hard to wear Auburn down because they play 10 different defensive linemen. Alabama wears other people down because they do not substitute enough.
That was Gabe Wright with that stop at second down and 10. 4:05. And the clock running.
Do you hand the ball to A.J. McCarron and say, win us this one? It's man-to-man to the outside. Auburn is playing 10 men in the run defense.
They will play action.
That's where you got to go.
Goes left side. Yep. Amari Cooper has it.
You just got to go to it. If they force you to throw to that, you got a senior quarterback, Heisman candidate, two national championships. You got to trust that play.
And here's Cooper again. He has been the star receiver in this evening's game. Third down, 2. 3:25 to go.
If they don't get a first down, what is Nick going to do on this one?
It's Yeldon in the backfield. They'll keep it on the ground. Yeldon tries to turn the corner. Does. Flag. Holding. Bring it back. Oh, my gosh. Did you see the punch thrown in the end zone? And there's the flag there. DeAndre White got popped.
Well, how silly was that? That would have been a 15-yard penalty.
Yep. That's Mincy who threw the punch.
And I'll tell you, Carl Lawson, the freshman, is telling Mincy, what are you doing?
There it is, at the goal line.
Right there, one shove, and then a late punch. If he would have just resisted and been a team player there, he's going to cost his football team.
Take another slightly better look at the punch. Right corner of the screen. Here's Yeldon. There's DeAndre White and Jonathan Mincy.
DeAndre White does shove him first, yes, yep. But the punch back. And another one, and then a final one. I wonder, they might call him offsetting here, though.
I wonder, yeah.
Yep.
With multiple fouls on the play.
Yep, they will.
Holding 98 offense. That penalty will be marked off 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Following the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Number two of the offense. Number six of the defense. Both fouls offset. And repeat third down.
They both were dead ball fouls, so yep. The holding penalty will hold, will be counted off. So an easy first down. Let's see if it was holding.
O.J. Howard.
End of the line of scrimmage. He held number 11, Chris Davis, and they called it.
And then the penalties, the offsetting penalties. I only saw Mincy. That's typical. You see the second one.
Yeah, see, it was actually White. If White would have not done it back,
yeah,
it might have been offsetting. So now it's third and long, and they're out, probably out of field goal range. Not only that, they had a first down with 3 minutes to go.
Yep. Third down, 12. Under three to play. Howard splits off wide to the right. Cooper, top of the screen.
Just a four-man rush again.
McCarron is hit as he lets it go. It'll be fourth down. Gabe Wright, number 90.
Pressure by number 55, Carl Lawson. Fourth down.
Wow. Man, that is a pass rush from Gabe Wright. Now it's about a 45-yard field goal?
Foster's career long is 53. He has missed today from 44 and 33.
Well, everybody would forgive him if he makes this one for Alabama. The Auburn fans say, come on, one more wide left.
Cole Mazza snaps it. A.J. McCarron holds it. Cade Foster kicks it, and it's going to be wide left. It's blocked. It's blocked. Terese Robinson blocked it. Ryan Smith picks it up, and the nightmare continues for Cade Foster.
And there's a late hit. There's going to be a 15-yard penalty on top of all this as well. It was blocked up the middle.
Following the play, dead ball, personal foul, 89 of the kicking team. 15-yard penalty, first down.
Saban, Malzahn. Give me another piece of double bubble.
Well, right now, it's four down territory. It's the ball game.
Penalty was on Brandon Green, backup tight end. First down, 10, 2, 32 to go. Auburn has all three of its timeouts. Uzuma in motion. They hand it off up the middle, Trey Mason. What a game he's had. And they go in a hurry.
Yeah, an interesting strategy here for Gus. He wants to obviously score, but he doesn't want to give Alabama time either.
Mason this time is stopped. And after the penalty a moment ago, Nick Saban, Brandon Green. Third 2nd and 2. Late add is Corey Grant. Hustles onto the field.
They don't have enough guys out there. Alabama does not. All right, here comes another one.
Adrian Hubbard was late.
Alabama will have to take a timeout.
Time taken. Crimson Tide. Hubbard was the late arrival. Plus holding their breath here, no matter if you're wearing orange and blue or you're decked out in crimson and white. 28-21, and Auburn with a chance for the tie. 3rd and 2 at the Auburn 43. What do you think?
I think they would have run it 2 times up the middle to get a first down is what I think.
Way to go, coach.
Yes. Trey Mason has been the best third down back in college football. 17 of 24 times on third down he's made a first down when he's carried the ball. I give it to Trey Mason.
And they do. And he does. 1:38 to go. Clock stops on the first down.
Powered inside. Right up. Dismukes. Reese Dismukes, one of their veteran offensive linemen.
First down from the 48.
First down 10, 90 seconds remaining. Mason again. Trade to Priest gets him number 33 on this carry.
It'll be tough to stop this offense with 4 downs to pick up a first down.
Second down 5.
Second and 5. Mason again. That's his 28th carry of the ball game.
Mason carries up the middle.
Gus will want to go fast here. I guarantee it.
1 minute to go. 28-21, winner take all. DePriest almost broken. Mason.
Yep, they're going to go to Mason on third down. He's a third down machine.
And they hustle. First down and 10 at the 40. Marshall keeps it, tries to get around the edge, tips it out. It's caught by Sammy Coates, strolls in, touchdown, Auburn.
Triple option right at the last second. Nick Marshall saw Sammy Coates. Hardly blame the Alabama defender on that one. He thought for sure Marshall was keeping it.
Cody Parkey, we are tied.
There's that play, the triple option play working again. A.J. McCarron's got 32 seconds. Fake it, keep it, and at the last second, he knows he's not going to make it. And Cyrus Jones, hard to say, you can't come up and tackle the guy, and by a yard, he was behind the line of scrimmage. It was really close.
The question becomes, where is he when he lets it go? That's the line of scrimmage.
That's fine. He's behind the line. That works. Both Cyrus Jones and HaHa Clinton Dix both reacted to the run. And Sammy Coates says that's a third part of the option. We do it all the time in practice. It was like Nick Marshall was playing basketball on that one. Fast break. Not there. Flip it out. I didn't even have the laces that time.
Coates, such a talented young man, and he catches the 39-yard toss from Nick Marshall. 28 all. This one is grabbed short. That's Ryan Anderson, the linebacker. 25 seconds to go.
Nick Marshall was carrying this ball in his left hand when he comes out. It's in his left hand, and then he has to switch it at the last second to make the throw. That's why he didn't have the laces, and it wasn't pretty, but it sure worked.
Well, he's a basketball player and a football player. That looked a little bit like a shot put. 25 seconds to go. Two timeouts. McCarron throws it away. Ladarius Owens, who had his jersey stitched during a break earlier, had the pressure on McCarron that time. 16 seconds remaining in regulation. Draw play. Yelled it. Stopped short of the first down. Timeout. Alabama.
I think Alabama should try that long tip play down the middle of the field right here.
7 seconds to go. And we've talked throughout the evening, Gary, about the passion that the fan bases bring. About a month ago, my wife Nancy and I were driving from Tuscaloosa to Atlanta. We stopped for lunch in Oxford, Alabama. We bought a coffee mug, one for Auburn, one for Alabama, went to pay for them. The young lady at the cash register said, "Y'all buying these for gifts, or are y'all a split family?"
They got some of those here, don't they?
Yeah, they do. Third and one.
You know,
Cade Foster.
It, one of them obviously blocked, but he did not get any height on it. And if it goes to overtime, that's going to be a big disadvantage to Alabama. As they call plays, they can't be confident that they've got a way to kick a field goal.
7 seconds remaining in regulation. Here comes Alabama's Hail Mary.
Yeah,
no, they
yeah,
are. Yeah. Did he get out of bounds? He did. Apparently, Gosh, I thought he crossed the line with a second to go.
Well, it is reviewable. 2-1 hits. It's pretty close, but if they put 1 second on, obviously they'll get one Hail Mary throw to the end zone.
Well, Matt Austin has called this one over in regulation.
There we go. Fifth quarter.
Appropriate. Here's the clock on the left side. Yeldon bumped out of bounds.
But his foot actually doesn't touch, I don't think, until it hits zero. His foot is in midair. I think it's over. I really do. And I think it's the right
call. The rolling of the clock expiring on the play is under review.
See, his right foot doesn't come down until it's all zeros.
Right.
And there's no tenths. See, his right foot comes down right now. And there's a one on there. I have to say, there's a one on there. So we will see. The replay official has been aggressive tonight, hasn't he? He's overruled two already.
That's right.
It's when his right foot comes down It's not when he crosses an imaginary line. It's when his foot hits in the white.
And so we wait.
Oh, but for a field goal for Alabama, huh?
Yes. Foster 0 for 3 in the tying touchdown set up when his third effort was blocked by Robinson Therese. And remember now that Alabama had a first down holding call and offsetting penalties in the end zone.
You know, Vern, I'm not even sure that Therese got that block. I thought it didn't get enough height on it, and it was blocked in the line. That was such another low, poor kick
right
by Foster.
And so the review continues. And what's at stake here, obviously, is a Hail Mary for Alabama to break the tie. As if that's all. A chance to go to Atlanta. The possibility of a third consecutive BCS appearance and championship. Here's the split screen. See what we can find out.
And the computer has these two in sync. It's when his right foot touches. Right? Not yet. Now.
There. Yeah, there's a second left. If the synchronicity works. Well,
from our stuff.
Yep.
CBS says there's a second left. If that clock is official.
It is.
They're going to give them one more chance, aren't they?
And we await the ruling. Here's Matt Austin.
After review, the runner's foot touched out of bounds at the 39-yard line with 1 second on the clock. Clock will be reset to 1 second. It'll be first and 10.
Well, if anyone should know the lesson of knocking it down, should it not be the Auburn defensive backs? They're going to try a field goal?
It's Adrian Griffith, who is 1 for 2 tonight. Yes, career, not tonight.
56 yards.
Griffith. Adam Griffith, a redshirt freshman from Calhoun, Georgia. This is the third field goal he's attempted in his career. 56 yards for the win, but first.
Be a 30-second timeout.
Timeout taken.
There's barely any wind. But if there is, it's left to right behind his back.
Adam Griffith, 1 of 2 this season. Foster, here's his first attempt tonight.
That was on the opening drive.
Yep. Here's his second. That was after a penalty. He had made one that hooked it from 33. And this one, you said before we saw the replay, then you thought it might have been blocked in the line.
I didn't think he got enough height on it.
Van Tiffin kicked one from 52 yards in 1985. One of the legendary moments in the Iron Bowl history. And here is a red shirt freshman from Calhoun, Georgia. Very little wind. What small amount there is at his back. Mandel will hold it. Now they've officially made it 57 yards.
Remember, a blocked kick can go the other way, too. He's got to be careful and get it up.
On the way. No, returned by Chris Davis. Davis goes left. Davis gets a block. Davis has another block. Chris Davis. No flags. Touchdown, Auburn, an answered prayer. might be worth another look.
You know what we need to do is come back here more often. These are the two most unbelievable finishes. A forced deep field goal, and now Alabama does not have athletes on the field. They've got offensive linemen on the field. And once Chris Davis turns the corner, the only thing that was going to stop him was he fell down. It was a decent kick.
Yes, it was.
But a big gamble. I thought maybe a block this could happen. Who would have dreamed that this? Because there's no athletes on the field for Alabama. They got all fat guys.
Mandel places it down. Griffith. As Gary said, it's a decent kick. Now, it will officially go into the books as a 100-yard return with a missed field goal because the NCAA does not measure from deep in the end zone.
Burn for Auburn, 2013. It will always be remembered as the season every Auburn fan dreamed but never believed has happened.
Is with Gus Malzahn.
Just this atmosphere right now, he can't even really hear what I'm saying, I'm sure.
Yeah,
but what can you say, just 2 weeks in a row here at Jordan-Hare Stadium and coming out with this win, so important.
It's really unbelievable. I said earlier, if it's close, I thought we were going to win. Our guys are resilient, and I couldn't be more prouder right now.
The biggest turnaround in SEC history, and now you're on your way to the SEC championship. How proud are you of your team today?
Hey, it's kind of been one of those dream seasons. We got better every week. We're playing our best ball right now, and I'm real excited.
What was going through your mind on that final field goal there and the return as it was happening?
Yeah, we just talked about it. I didn't know if he had the legs, so we put our punt returner back there. Chris Davis took it to the house. The place went nuts.
Well, it was a great move. Congratulations. Enjoy every minute of it.
Thank you.
How ironic that they put a second back on the clock.
The Auburn fans and team was upset about the extra second. We all assumed Alabama would throw a Hail Mary. But when they went for the field goal attempt, boy, so many things in this game, so many decisions. Nick Saban not going for a field goal made it a 7-point game. Here he goes for a field goal, and Chris Davis turns it upside down.
Brandon Fulce got a great block on the return. Ryan Smith got a great block on the return. Jonathan Mincy makes the only tackle on Chris Davis on that play. This is one of the wildest scenes I have ever seen in college football. This field is just filled with orange and blue. Well, let's go down to Tracy, who's with Chris Davis.
Well, Chris, they wanted to hoist you on their shoulders and carry you away, but I wouldn't allow them. Before that field goal, what did he say to you guys?
He just told us, you know, watch the fake. And Coach Cheese made the decision to put me back there and catch it. And when I caught it, I just ran, tried to make something happen for the team.
What can you say about this turnaround, what you experienced last year in the Iron Bowl, and what you're experiencing now?
You know, we just stayed together. We fought through adversity. You know, this team is relentless. And together was our thing coming into this year, and that's what we did.
How much are you looking forward to that SEC championship game next week in Atlanta?
We'll be looking forward to it. We're going to go this week and prepare for whoever we got to play. And we know it's going to be a tough game, but we'll pull it out.
Good luck.
luck. Enjoy the moment right now.
Thank you.
And another look, Gary, from the high end zone camera of Chris Davis's return.
His momentum almost took him out of bounds on the play. His left foot, then his right foot, one more. When he cuts, he doesn't put his heel down. The only guy that could have made the tackle was Robinson Parisi. Watch number 27. I thought he was going to catch his feet together. A long field goal attempt. I thought the most risky part was a block. I guess there were two risky parts. Two of the craziest endings in back-to-back games here I've ever seen.
I don't think there's ever been a 2 weeks like this in Jordan-Hare. And the dream of a third consecutive BCS championship appears to have ended for Nick Saban and Alabama. And A.J. McCarron loses for only the third time. There's his girlfriend, Catherine Webb, and his mom, Dee Dee Bonner. Catherine Webb, incidentally, is an Auburn grad. Well, we thought for a while that we might have a 99-yard pass for Alabama as the Napa Auto Parts
right.
play of the game. Guess what? Here is Rod Bramlett for the second time in 2 weeks with his call of the last play of the ball game.
Well, I guess if this thing comes up short, he can field it and run it out. All right, here we go. 56-yarder. It's got, no, does not have the leg. And Chris Davis takes it in the back of the end zone. He'll run it out to the 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 45. There goes Davis.
Oh, my God.
Davis is going to run it all the way back. Auburn's going to win the football game. Auburn's going to win the football game. He ran the missed field goal back. He ran it back 109 yards. They're not going to keep him off the field tonight. Holy cow.
I think those are two terrific calls from Rob Bramlett tonight and 2 weeks ago on the prayer from Jordan-Hare.
And just lost in all of this, that great decision that Nick Marshall made on the pass to Sammy Coates, the 99-yard touchdown pass, 15 or 20 different decisions by Nick Saban, and Gus Malzahn pulls it out. What a year coaching for Gus Malzahn.
Well, Malzahn and his wife, Christy, have a habit of going to the Waffle House
Waffle House
celebrate
night.
Victories. After that game 2 weeks ago, they went and sat at the counter and were never served. So they left. Guess what? There's a table reserved for Gus and Christy Malzahn tonight. Wow. For Gary Danielson and Tracy Wolfson, along with our guys in the truck, Craig Silver, Steve Milton, our leaders, our entire crowd. Bernd Lundquist saying so long from Auburn. The final score, 34-28. Tigers win. Jeep postgame show is up next after these messages and a word from your local station.
Well, I guess if this thing comes up short, he can field it and run it out. All right, here we go. 56-yarder. It's got, no, does not have the leg. And Chris Davis takes it in the back of the end zone. He'll run it out to the 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50, 45. There goes Davis.
Oh, my God.
Davis is going to run it all the way back. Auburn's going to win the football game. Auburn's going to win the football game. He ran the missed field goal back. He ran it back 109 yards. They're not going to keep him off the field tonight. Holy cow.
CBS Sports presents the Jeep Postgame Show.
Welcome to the Jeep Postgame Show. I'm Tim Brando. A reminder, tonight on CBS, celebrate the holiday season with The Flight Before Christmas and the story of Santa Claus. A few Auburn fans will like that. Followed by a new edition of 48 Hours that's coming up tonight. Only CBS. In the game you just saw, another incredible finish for Auburn. The Iron Bowl goes to the Tigers, 34-28. Yes, I'm joined by Spencer Tillman and Brian Jones. There you see the tail of the tape on the day. And let's just say at the War Eagles Supper Club tonight, where that sign was I talked about on the College Football Today, hot rock, cold beer, show no mercy.
Yeah.
There will be no mercy in Toomer's Corner tonight.
Timmy, I got to give it to you. I think the SEC has just been cannibalized.
I believe it's official now.
It's official right now. You know, listen, guys, I think it was the late, it was a long time ago when it happened, but Torrey Holt, the NC State great, coined the phrase big plays, big days. Yeah. None bigger than today. I think this Auburn team has perfected the art of sucking the joy out of a moment for an opponent. They did it against Georgia. They just did it here against Nick Saban, who was seeking destiny, BJ. This was one for
him. And we talked about it, BJ. Destiny this time beats dynasty.
Exactly. And they never gave up. And I talked about withstanding. That's jabs from Alabama. And they kept withstanding the jab. Yeah, they let some opportunities go to this aside. But they did what they needed to do to get a huge victory.
Yeah, it was incredible. Absolutely was incredible. No denying that. And one other factor that we need to talk about. We're going to show you the play one more time. This time, the call from Eli Gold, the longtime play-by-play man of the Crimson Tide. You heard what Rod Bramlett had to say from Auburn. How about Eli Gold's call? Listen to this.
It's got leg. It is sailing. It is short. It is grabbed about 8 yards deep in the end zone. Brought back to the near side. Run down the near sideline. There's nobody there for Alabama. Auburn's going to win. Auburn is going to win the Iron Bowl on a run back of a missed.
Chris Davis from Birmingham, Alabama, senior cornerback, makes the final play in what had to be, fellas, we have to remember this, a self-induced moment.
Right, the 1 second.
Because it was Nick Saban that was lobbying very hard for that review. He got it. The referee, Matt Austin, said, you know what? You're going to get your chance to kick the field goal.
Yeah, let's go back to what, you know, we talked about during the pregame show and how that first miracle at Jordan-Hare and how that feeds and fuels that belief that this is something special that we're embarking on. They never said never quit, never die in this ball game. Mm-hmm. They kept making plays. And then when you continue to do that and you have that mindset, things like this happen. I've never seen it happen back-to-back games, but it does happen.
His mom, Janice, must be a very, very happy woman tonight. This was one of those moments, BJ, that just comes along once in a life.
Yes.
Yeah. Destiny this time wins out over Dynasty. Much more on this when the Jeep postgame show continues. Incredible. The SEC on CBS delivers again. Well, we dubbed it the prayer from Jordan-Hare. How about this one now? The second miracle.
Wow.
Playing on the 1 second that was left. Something that Nick Saban really wanted, but then probably will live to regret. All right, let's talk a little bit about Auburn, fellas. Potentially with this win and a win in the SEC championship game, Ohio State and Florida State are ahead of them. BCS schools never happened, undefeated, being jumped by a one-loss team. Is it feasible? Is it worth talking about?
I think it's more than worth talking about. We talked about in the pregame show that as closely as a mediocre Michigan team played Ohio State today, that a one-loss Auburn or a one-loss Missouri team had a legitimate shot at leapfrogging them, and I think that's an opportunity that could be still in play.
Well, Michigan is mediocre, but you can't discount rivalry games. I've rolled into the Texas OU ball game, unranked, taking on a top 10 Oklahoma game, and knock them off. Anything can happen in those ball games. You're playing on the road. So Ohio State's got to be firmly at number two. If Auburn wins the SEC championship, I think that's when this conversation will definitely heat up.
Well, it will certainly be very much part of the narrative. Well, fellas, I enjoyed the regular season. How about the postseason? You ready for the title game next
week? Listen, I'm spent right now.
I feel like I've been rolled hard and put up wet.
From the Garrett Jordan-Hare to the second miracle. That'll just about do it for this week. We're going to shower off and get ready to go to Atlanta.